This workshop with the joint service of the advisory committee. Thank you guys for coming. I really do appreciate it. Last time we had a joint meeting, only one of you showed up, which was Ms. Farrell, which is okay, but she got a lot of information. I hope she brought back to you guys during your last session and meeting. And you guys worked that well together. Also, just a small comment, if you're going to present your budget, if you can present it up here at the table so we can hear you and you can project so we can record it. And any side talk in the back, if you can just keep it down to a minimum, because we're trying to listen to what the budgets are and work well with the advisory committee. Please be respectful. And that, I appreciate it. Thank you.
I just want to say I would have attended that meeting, but I was precluded because I was looking after a sick friend.
Understood. No worries. Thank you, though. I appreciate that. First order of business is the appointments. Yeah, we have two appointments for the screening committee, which we discussed at the last meeting. So we have...
Only two items.
What are the appointments? Can I see them?
No, just a book. And your packet's right here.
All right.
Can I see the appointment?
Yep. You can make a motion, yep.
So I make a motion to appoint John Driscoll and Kevin Byrd for the Town Administrator Screening Committee to serve until their duties are ended.
Right, I have a motion or a second?
Second.
A motion, second. Any discussion concerning the appointment of Mr. Driscoll and Mr. Byrd? I see none. John?
Tim, can we do this separately, please?
You want to do separate what?
Can we do a separate vote?
A separate vote?
Yeah.
For each individual?
Yes.
We could, yeah.
I appreciate that.
Okay, can you amend your... He wants to do a separate... He requested a separate vote for each individual versus collectively on each one.
Okay, so I rescind my motion. You have to rescind your second.
Second.
Okay, motion's been rescinded.
I'm sorry, can I have that again?
Yes, you may.
Can I make a motion to appoint John Driscoll to the Town Administrator Screening Committee until their completion of their duties?
Okay, that's... I have a second.
Second.
Okay, motion, second. Any other discussion? I see none. John?
Yes.
Doug?
Yes.
Diane?
Yes.
And I vote yes as well.
I make a motion to appoint Kevin Byrd to the Town Administrator Screening Committee until their completion of their duties.
Okay, I have a motion of a second.
Second.
I have a motion, second. Any discussion concerning Mr. Byrd? I see none. John?
No.
Diane?
Yes.
Doug?
Yes.
And I vote yes as well. Thank you. Moving on, we're gonna start with the with finance and administration. Probably start with the accountant.
Sure.
Is that okay with everybody?
We're gonna find the accountant's budget starting at page 43.
Hi, Kelly.
Hi, Kelly. Thank you for coming. I appreciate it. Personnel?
So the personnel in the office would be myself full-time.
Yep.
There would be an assistant town accountant, and this is splitting in the treasurer's office. There would be one full-time and two part-time. So the other part of that part-time would then come into the accounting office, and that person would handle the vendor warrants, the payroll, the benefit section, plus the fixed assets. The fixed assets have not been taken care of in the town for a number of years, and that really needs to be a focus. That's one of the things that came out in the audit, is that we really need somebody that can spend a good amount of time working on that and keeping that up to date every year going forward.
Okay.
So that would be for the personnel.
Okay.
The employee support.
Hold on 1 second. Anybody have any questions with personnel?
Yes. You said this would be partly in the treasurer's?
No. Currently, there's two full-time and one part-time in the treasurer's office.
Yeah.
With the new budget proposal, it would be one full-time and two part-time.
Okay, I'm sorry, I misunderstood you.
So that half, that other part-time would be in the accounting office. It would be the same amount of, same amount, but it would just be split.
Understood, okay.
Do you see a need, I'm sorry, John?
No, go ahead, Diane, please.
That's okay.
Do you see a need for floating hours?
Actually, I mean, I don't know why there would be the floating hours, because it would be, to me, a set 19 and a half.
They were.
Yeah, but.
I'd be happy to answer.
Yes, please.
They were added because there are peak times during the year in preparation for the audit, perhaps, but also at the time of putting the budget together. And those were added to cover those two time periods.
But if there's no floating hours in our documentation.
Yeah.
Sir, was.
These are floating hours.
It's floating. The last line, 700.
Oh, that's to cover vacations, I love. Because you're eligible for vacation. So to keep your hours, your office open for the required amount of time when you're on vacation, your assistant's going to have to work more.
We have a backup.
So the line two is to cover her additional hours, or your, that person's hours. And then the third line is to cover your vacation time.
Plus.
So I see no, well, don't you get 2 weeks of vacation?
Yes.
So that's exactly the amount you need to cover vacation.
Understood.
So there is no floating hours in here. And if they are floating hours, it should be labeled as floating hours.
So the main duties would be benefits, payroll, and vendor warrants?
The vendor warrant, the payroll, and the benefits, and then the fixed assets.
Okay.
So there, that would be their four main focus of their duties.
And how long does it take to do payroll each week? Conservatively, not for somebody who knows exactly how to.
Probably five hours.
And how long does it take to do vendor warrants?
Vendor warrants are probably, depending on the week, it could be as much as a day, could be a half a day. It just depends on the timing. I mean, when we didn't have the spending freeze, it would take a full day. Now that we have the spending freeze right now, it takes about a half a day. You know, it just depends on the spending and what's happening at that time.
Okay, thank you.
Is anybody talking about going to like two-week pay every other week?
We did recommend that as one of the things for you to work on.
Was that in the workshop?
First thing, yeah, in the original presentation.
Right.
Save you about $4,000.
Right.
Bucks, probably save you about 80 staff hours over the course of a year.
Right.
The first challenge is it is a collective bargaining issue.
Understood, okay.
The second challenge is that usually you end up giving the staff a pretty good head start, 9 months, 6 months, 9 months, even a year.
To let them know it's coming?
To let them know it's coming and to work with them so they can set something aside.
Okay. All right, I was just curious.
And just to add to that, with the collective bargaining, this has been discussed several times in the 2 years I've been here, and the police department is not for that at all. So I think that would be, because if we're going to do it for one, we have to do it for all. And I think that the police department, a lot of the officers are not, they have no intention of doing that.
Okay.
It's kind of like the same with the direct deposit.
Right.
You know.
Not everybody's direct deposit?
No. You know, you have to get, you know, I mean, you have to, on the collective bargaining side, all of those things have to be part of those contracts.
Okay.
So, you know, that's a big hurdle for both of those issues.
Okay. Thank you so much. Okay, any other questions with personnel?
No.
Okay, good, moving on.
Do you have questions?
Oh, yes.
Your job was what, before your hours got increased, 30 hours, 35?
It was 25.
25?
Yes.
So now all the work of all the audits, and I know it was an incredible amount of work, and I know you worked real hard.
Right.
But that's all behind us now for the most part.
Correct.
Do you have enough work so that you can work 40 hours and then need a?
There is still a huge amount of work that needs to be done on, in the prior years where the accounts receivables don't balance. I mean, we had to move forward to get through the audits, but there is a significant amount of prior year work that needs to be done to figure out these errors and things that have happened. So yes, there is, you know, because that's very long, tedious work to be able to do that. So, yes.
Isn't the payroll, shouldn't that be done by the treasurer?
No, at this point, it needs to be part of the accounting office so that they're, I've spoken with a couple of other towns, and the treasurer does the payroll, but then everything comes to the accountant.
Okay.
And it goes through them to make sure as the double check, and that's not happening at this point. So it would be that person in that office, you know, the part-time person that would be processing it, then it would come over to me and I would review that. Since the treasurer collector position has been combined,
yep.
That person really needs to focus a lot on the collecting and the treasurer, and that's one of the items that could be taken out of that office to alleviate, to make more time so that we can get more revenue in the town.
In the DOR report, they told us to do payroll twice a week, that it'd save us money. That was one of the suggestions that they made.
Right.
And it's too bad that the selectmen just can't say because of financial problems,
yeah.
This is the way we're going to do it, because they work for you. You don't work for them.
Yeah, when the unions
know?
Are involved, it's a whole
too
different,
bad because
yeah.
That would make it a lot easier. It would probably cut our costs in half. Okay, thank you.
Can I speak to that?
Yes.
Unfortunately, Bev, as Kelly just explained, we have collective bargaining
yeah,
agreements,
yeah.
And they're the ones. So the selectmen can't just make a vote and make an edict. So
yeah,
we have to go with what is bargained, what is
within the contract.
Yeah,
right.
It's too bad.
Okay, so we have to start negotiating the future contracts to allow for that.
Yes.
What you're saying.
Yes.
I believe that has been brought up, though.
It has. I mean, both the police department's aware, and
instead of doing something four times, you only do it two.
Right. No, you're right. It's been talked about. Thank you.
Okay.
Thanks. Going on to employee support.
In the 2 years that I've been here,
yeah.
The questions have been about me becoming a certified town accountant. I have not been able, in the time frame of my work,
mm-hmm.
to be able to take the enormous amount of classes that are need to be taken in order for me to become certified. So this is the page of all the different classes, the conferences, the things that I need to attend to become certified. So everything on this page, the 32, you know, the 3,250 is basically to get me to be a certified town accountant.
Okay. And you feel within this 1 year you're going to have enough time to complete all these courses?
Yes, because I don't have the pressure of getting the audits done. If I need to be out of the office a few days for classes and things like that, you know, that should be, you know, it's like I said, the work that I'm going to begin now that the audits are completed, I mean, it doesn't matter if it takes extra time because the audits are completed. These are things that are going to be fixed in the coming years.
Okay, because like Abrams boot camp, that's a week, I believe, right?
Yes.
And then then you got the Abrams U Mass Training, which I believe is 2 weeks.
The Abrams Municipal Law.
Right.
That's 2 days.
No, I'm talking number that 999, the Abrams UMass training down at UMass. Is that a week or is that 2 weeks?
No, the UMass training, that is like 10 weeks, and I think it's 2 days or 1 day a week.
Okay.
For 10 weeks.
I got you. Okay, I was just curious.
Yeah.
Thank you. Does anybody have any questions with this? Yes.
Is it typical when you're going for this to do it all in 1 year, or do they typically spread it out longer because it's a lot of classes?
It can be done, however. I just know that has been a big issue that has been, you know, I don't even know how to word that, about not having certified people in this town. And so this has become, now that the audits are completed, this is my priority
okay.
that I have put forth.
Another thing, this is more on the administrator column. Just so I understand, what's lump sum disallowed?
That's the amount of money that when the town administrator went through it, he disallowed the 53 because he wants solid numbers, like not He wants even numbers. Is that how you worded, Mr. Tanzini?
Yeah, there's two things that go on. One is it's my own querity, the way I have budgets end. The second is that I can go through many of these departments and they can make a good solid argument for every single item. And this is my way of cutting the budgets, nipping and tucking them here and there, when they in fact have made that good argument for every single item. And I'm still looking to squeeze some money out of the budget.
Okay, so we basically could, by disallowing that, come up short if these are the expenses and not be able to fund all those classes.
Conceivably, if she went to every single one of these things and those prices carried out exactly and the mileage was exact, yeah, but I've not had that kind of problem in my experience.
Okay.
Thank you. Anything else? You have anything for that, John? Oh, yes.
This is
kind of like a workshop, right?
Yeah.
It's a workshop?
We
typically don't take questions from the crowd, but I if you want to write it down, you can give it to us afterwards, okay? Anything else? Advisory, you good? Okay, moving on to purchases and services.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
If I remember right, in the last budget workshop when they were presented, there were several questions and comments from the audience.
No, we told them no questions.
No, I think people did ask.
There was lots of people with the COA that spoke, and
right.
I just, that's how it was the last time, so.
I was only going to ask if someone from the audience is going to speak. Please could you stand if you are able, so that
okay.
I can read your lips.
I think it's, okay. What's your question?
If the, it's going to be away from the office
mm-hmm.
more to take all those courses, would you need more floating hours to keep the office open?
That's a great question. I'm not even going to play that at that point.
I think
yeah.
you have to remember that the town accountant is an internal service.
Yeah.
Office. They service
yeah.
only the other departments.
Right.
And when the other departments know, the office is going to be closed half a day on Wednesdays and Thursdays, you got to have your stuff in on Mondays and Tuesdays.
Right.
I really don't see it as a big problem.
Okay. I didn't foresee it as a big issue.
Okay.
Does that answer your question?
Yes.
Thank you, ma'am, for your question. Yes. Thank you, Kelly, for bringing it. My mind's not. purchases of services.
This is just three items. It's our VADAR support that we have to pay, which we have our still current package. There's nothing new.
Mm-hmm.
That's the current price for this year. We have the audit cost, which has already been contracted for it would be the FY17 audit, which we pay for in FY18.
Is that be the same company, I would assume?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. And then the OPEB calculation software. What we learned this year with the software that was purchased for our OPEB, and I'm sure it was just so many hands were in the pile doing that,
right.
and the calculations, it was not, it just didn't work.
Okay.
And at this point, for this $5,000, we could get an actuarial to come in and be able to potentially actually do our OPEB from the very beginning correctly, and would be easier going forward to make sure that we have good numbers for the OPEB. Because the auditor, the reports that came out at the end, they were way higher than towns of our similar size. So that's why the concern was that the reports were not good reports.
All right.
And these are actual costs, correct?
Yes.
Okay,
well,
so the lump sum disallowed means that if you have this as just an account, it would be negative.
Yeah. The OPEB calculation, that's really an estimate at
that's,
this point.
So it may
meaning less, it could be more.
It could be more.
Yeah.
Well,
we don't know at this point.
Remember, please, we're moving to a department level of line item control. So if she's over $80 in this one, under $42 in another one, and under 38 another one, it all washes through because we're moving off the line item by line item
right.
by line item control.
Okay, any questions with purchase of services?
The only thing we do want to, you know, note is that please understand that of next year's budget, you're not going to get a $28,000 buy again on your audit.
Right.
You'll need to start to think of at least
32.5. Okay.
End up.
Okay.
One more question.
Yes.
You said that we would have the same company do the audits
for FY17
and 18. We're not.
For FY18, we will have to go out again for a bid process. Okay. I'm not sure that Roselli and Clark will continue, but I, you know, they are locked in for the 5 years that we signed the contract with.
So and that we'll ends. To, that ends this year.
That'll end
in
on FY17. So they'll do one more audit for us in the fall of, you know, this coming year, which that's what this would pay for.
Sorry, got you.
And then the next year, we would have to go back out to do it.
Okay. Any other questions? Anybody guys have any questions? No?
Oh, where are we in the audits?
Well, we can talk about that after. We're just doing the budgets right now, if you don't mind, okay? Thank you, though. Any other questions? Moving on to supplies.
This is just a $500 for various types of office supplies, printer cartridges. I know we're looking at possibly putting together a contract for Xerox where we would all have the same machines,
mm-hmm.
the same toner cartridges, those types of things. But typically that's what's always been given to the accountants to use for, you know, various things,
okay.
postage, different,
I got
all
you.
Different things.
Any questions with that?
I have a question in general.
Yes.
When we're done, but regarding this.
Yes.
Obviously we all know that the budget's very tight in town.
Mm-hmm.
If cuts were needed to be made within your department budget here, it looks like, you know, really there's not a lot of places that would be able to be cut.
Mm-hmm.
It looks like it would either be in the education area or in the personnel time area.
Right.
What would you recommend if there had to be some, would you rather see, you know, spreading the education out over a couple of years or fewer hours and get the education part done with?
The simple answer to that would be there would have to stop being the pressure of there needs to be a certified person in these positions in town. That is quite... that pressure on the town employees is awful. I can tell you that from sitting in the chair. It personally, if I want to get this done and over with and off the table so that that's one less thing against me, I would prefer to lose the part-time person and get that training done.
Okay, thank you.
Kindly remember, if she were to lose the part-time person, this is an interwoven package.
It is, yeah.
Don't, let's not take that statement and run with it.
No. Okay.
Because you'd have to restore the halftime person over to the treasurer collector's office where the work's currently being done.
I only like to find out input from the department heads as to where their mindset is in priority. Doesn't necessarily mean that is the priority of the selectmen or the town.
All right.
I just, with the camera, I want to be clear for the camera.
Okay, yes.
That they cannot take that statement and run with it.
Right.
Oh, we will run all the way to Gardner and borrow some money. Your $500, you usually use it up in a year? I imagine you go through a lot of paper and envelopes.
Right now, the selectmen office buys all the paper for everything here in town hall. I can usually make it stretch, you know, with what I need. So.
All right. Thank you.
Good. Any other questions concerning this?
Okay. I'm just asking.
All right. So, any other questions?
John, I was asking Carter a question.
Okay. Anything else for the accountant?
Thanks, Kelly.
Thank you, Kelly, so much. I appreciate it. Good input. Let's start with the assessor.
Here she comes.
Dun, dun, dun.
Hi, Luann.
Page 47, Heatherway. It's good to see you.
You too. Okay, so
so we're gonna start with personnel?
Yes.
All right, so I've got mine, and then I've got my administrative assistant at 19.5 hours. And again, we've also put in floating hours for that one.
Yeah.
Floating hours, I've been with the town 18 years, so I get 5 weeks plus. So I mean, in the past, we've shut down my office, but it's nice having my assistant back, so.
Good. And that's working?
Keeping the hours would be great. And like I say, if I can keep the floating hours, that's a plus to me, and it would be really nice to have, so.
Question?
Yes.
That's okay.
So if you couldn't have the floating hours and the weeks that you're gone, have people complained, or, I mean, you usually put out on the website when we're closed, or has there been a lot of?
No, what I've done in the past, because I went 2.5, 3 years without an assistant in my office, mm-hmm. so I just posted on the website, office closed for the week. You know, you're welcome to throw things under my door, or leave them in a bin or something. When I get back, I'll do it.
Has anyone ever had to call you?
No, no. If anything, my guys are available to talk to. Other than that, they just wait till we come back in.
Okay, thank you.
Yes.
Yeah. Oh. It has down here 5 hours per year as a floating for the assistant. 5 hours a week. Five weeks per year.
Okay.
She would go up to like 36, 38 mm-hmm. hours. So she'd be there full time if
okay.
I was out.
All right.
The other question I had is I've seen that in some of the town administrators' updates on the web that your assistant has been used in other offices as well?
Actually, this year, because of the audits and everything, mm-hmm. I've let her help the accountant out in putting in accounts receivables and payables into the system, and then it's always cleared through the accountant. She rechecks everything. But she stays in my office, she answers my phones and checks the counters and stuff, and she does this above and beyond. She just stays at the desk and does data entry for the accountant.
Okay, and that comes out of your time, not
right, but
okay.
It's not really out of our time because, like I said, she is in the office, the phones are ringing, and that's her priority is to do our work first.
Okay.
Yep.
Thanks.
Yes.
I noticed on our rate, we aren't seeing in here the past rate. Is this current rate, or is this proposed pay rate changes?
No,
these are current rates.
Okay, I'm just making sure because
yeah.
I hadn't got a chance to look through the,
yep.
the other.
Yes,
there are some departments where the proposed rate for that year, so for instance, the public works superintendent, the fire chief, they have a rate for this year. The rate for next year is already fixed.
Mm-hmm.
So I can tell you department by department whether they're present or proposed.
Yeah, 'cause I'm not just talking the department head, but any of the other positions.
It's different department by department depending upon whether or not they had a contract, whether or not they have a collective bargaining agreement.
Will it be noted in here when it's an increase from
that? No.
Okay.
No, I'll have to tell you.
Just let me know.
Well, because the highway next year gets a raise based on their contract.
Right. There's, I know
there's a $2 increase per person.
Yeah.
So. Oh, so I think what Gordon is asking is, as you go through, are these reflective of?
With
so
current.
It, you're right, because if it was reflective of current and they were getting. Increase,
yeah.
And that wasn't reflected in here, we'd run out of money.
I see what you're saying.
We got both aspects, that and, you know,
yeah.
I want to know if
they get a raise.
If this is getting, well, we have to keep an eye on every dollar right now, and we definitely need to pay people what they're worth, but we have to know when those raises are happening.
Understood. Mm-hmm. All right. So these are current, as far as these are current rates. Employee support.
Okay, my expense budget for employee support. Pretty much standard, my MAAO dues and my Worcester County Assessor's dues. This year, I do have money in there for education. For the last 2.5 years, I haven't been able to go to school. My board appoints me every year with the stipulation that I am working for my MAA accreditation. So right now, I took another course last August. I'm taking one right now currently. So I've done 4 of my 6 classes that I have to take. So, I mean, I have no deadline when I have to take them. The classes are always 36 to 45 hour classes that I have to take and pass. So like I said, because of the 2.5 years where we've had budget cuts, I've had to rule out education. it doesn't seem to be an issue with the public, and they know I'm working to be certified, and I do go to workshops every year too, so. We will see schoolings in there this year. Also, we put on our budget this year is mileage, because we don't have vehicles in the town, and I go out and do a lot of the property record cards and inspections, so we did add mileage to our budget this year. And also, I offer my notary services to the town as a free service to anybody in the public coming in, plus all the other departments in town. A lot of them come in and have me notarize things for them.
Mm-hmm.
So this year, I did add that to my expense account as an increase. I don't know if you've got any questions on.
So when you finish those two classes?
I'll be MAA certified.
Excellent.
What is miscellaneous?
Miscellaneous, actually, I don't believe in miscellaneous lines, but because of like Carter taking all of this page and putting it on that page, my miscellaneous, actually, I've added some money because I have a company called Esri, which is part of my mapping situation, cartographics, and I didn't have a line item or it got cut, so that's part of my miscellaneous. Also, some of my equipment repair would have to come out of that, because if you look on the next sheet, it was cut on that page. So that's kind of just anything that got cut on next sheets will be coming out of that. I really don't use a miscellaneous account if I don't have to.
Any questions? Yes.
What is the mileage for reimbursement?
The federal reimbursement for 2017?
Yeah.
I believe it's 53 cents.
53 and a half.
Yeah.
And anything above that, so if we paid 54, that other half cent, by law, has got to be counted as income for the individual that received it.
Right.
So in my opinion, we should be giving 53 cents
yep.
as the mileage reimbursement.
For 2017.
For everybody.
Across the board.
Yeah.
And we will bring you, I'll try to have it ready for the next meeting. I doubt I'll be able to, though. This came up at the last one, and I'm drafting a amendment to the personnel plan so that everyone will be using the same rate.
Okay, the 53 cent, okay.
And a method by which it's established every year going into the budget season, instead of every department kind of trying to remember what they think the IRS rate is.
I got you.
Because under the accountant's mileage, it was 57.
I saw that.
Correct, right.
Yeah.
And I think, you know, our mileage policy needs to be that mileage incurred that you want reimbursement for has to be requested or on a warrant within 30 days. I mean, we shouldn't be putting mileage down 6 months later for what we did, you know, 6 months ago, and there needs to be some accountability as to what these miles were for.
I know in the past when I used to work at the sewer, we used to have a sheet every month we returned in. It would say start time, whatever, return the next amount, and at the end of the month you turn it in to get.
Right, because again, if it's more than 30 days, then it's ineligible, for, in my opinion.
What's the federal rate reimbursement for
53.5.
How much?
53.5.
Oh,
cents.
Okay. Thank you.
For 2017. Any questions with the purchases and services?
Okay. Gardner News, I get a paper daily. It's in my office. A lot of times when things come through, the accountant will come in and she'll use it. Carl and the zoning board and building departments, they come in just to check if their legal ads are in. I need to have the legal ads in my office because of foreclosures and everything going on with properties in town. So it's pretty much a community subscription for the town building, and I just have it in my office. The other legal ad is when I do my classification hearing once a year in December for the tax rate. Equipment repairs, and my vision software is the whole real estate program for the town. In the past, they've only charged me for one user. It kind of caught up. Plus, we had a few glitches in the system. My system crashed 3 times in 2 years. So Vision, finally, we're getting in sync with them. And now it's increased $1,960 this year to have a second user in my office using the Vision program. So that's the big jump in my budget this year. It went from $1,800 to $1,960. So that's why the vision's up there. Cartographics is the online mapping program we have. You're finding a lot of our appraisers and realtors are now using that online site. So that's a real good site that we keep up and maintain. That's maintained and updated every year and through my office at least every quarter. Record preservation, that's just, we have microfilm storage at Eastern Micrographics. That's just a yearly fee that I do and are required to keep our records there. Anybody has any questions on those?
Okay. Any questions? Yes.
How much did you have for vision?
Vision, it went up $1,960 this year.
So the total is
$6,000.
$195.
$195, okay.
And the $4,400, that's correct as well?
Yes, that's correct. So that's pretty much most of my expense budget right there.
Okay. Any other questions about the expense budget? Supplies?
Office supplies, I just put $1,000 down. It's, and I do use that, I don't waste buying stuff, but cartridges, I go through a lot of cartridges for property record cards, also commitments for the town. I do a 900-page report every 3 months for our commitments for the town, so I do go through a lot of printing and stuff, so $1,000 to me is a very level funded expense.
Any questions about the supplies? Expense budget?
Expense budget, postage, $600. I think I've been using that figure for the last couple of years. Usually I don't have much left over in it. And Worcester Registry of Deeds, $26. It doesn't sound like a lot, but every month, if you can ask Kelly, I get a bill from the Registry of Deeds. Anytime people file plans in the town, registry has to send me a copy of those plans, and they charge me $2. Every time they send me plans, so that's only enough to cover 13 plans. Will I run short? Maybe, but if it is at cases where I'd hit miscellaneous and pay up for the difference on that too, so.
Now I know where, how you keep track of what people do.
What was it?
Now I wondered about that one time. If somebody goes and makes a change, how would you know that?
Yeah, no, Worcester Registry of Deeds, I'm on that at least 3, 4, 5 times a day checking record changes, so.
Any questions about that? Yes, Gordon.
We're done with the overall, just the same general question I wanted to, are we done with?
Yeah, I have a question. Oh, sorry.
Go ahead.
So I've noticed not just in your budget, and this might not be a best question for you, but there's postage in other budgets too. And do we have a postage machine?
No.
You don't, and I think it's something you should seriously look at over the coming year, having a centralized location and having more control over that.
I think it's a good idea too. I mean, I do a lot of mail.
Would you save? I think we would just, I don't know if we would save.
It's a control, it's more of a control issue, because you're gonna spend on the order of $200 plus or minus a month to rent the meter, the scale, and everything else.
Well, I noticed too that there was a, I forget which budget it's in, that there's envelopes with postage already on them, and I think that that is too costly. And if you ruin an envelope, there goes the postage too, and I mean, I don't really know how much postage is at the moment, because you just buy the forever stamps, but you know, that's throwing away money, and you know, although you say like $2, you know, it's not a lot, but it is, because it adds up, and you have to do that. So I was just wondering if we could look in, I mean, is that a, we should look into getting a postage meter?
That's something we should look at over the coming year.
Okay, thank you.
Any other questions?
Yeah, and the general overall, again, that they asked the accounts to cut. If there was something that, you know, we had to look at cutting, where would you recommend the cuts to be made?
Well, overall, in this year's budget and my expenses, my budget went down already $1,200. So I hashed and trashed and cut a lot out of my budget already from level funding, so it's under $1,200 from last year's level funding. So cut, there's not a lot more you can cut. The floating hours, if you needed to cut them, I'd say, okay, that would be fine. It would be nice to have somebody in the office, but we've been able to do it and muddle through, and I do have a good assistant, so we just do her hours too. But like I say, as far as the expenses and stuff, I don't want to lose an assistant, so I wouldn't recommend cutting our assistants again this year, because me and the town clerk did it for 2.5 years, and it was horrible. So that would be what I would be, is my floating hours. And like I say, my expense budget's already under $1,200 from last year.
Really good job, Luann.
So having those individuals increases services to the community?
I'm sorry.
Having the assistants increases services to the community?
Yes, it does, yeah.
Okay, thank you.
It's nice to have someone.
Yep, awesome.
Thanks, Luann.
Thanks, Luann.
Thank you.
Want to take the town clerk next?
Sure.
Page 101 for the town clerk.
And skip on the treasurer?
I'll do hers when the others are done, unless you want me to touch on it. That way I thought we could get folks on their way.
What page, I'm sorry?
101.
Thanks.
Hi, Carol.
Hi.
Hi, Leanne. Good to see you. So we start with personnel?
Okay, so you have myself and the assistant with the extra hours for to cover vacation. I have added the town moderator. Carter suggested that he, where I do the elections and town meetings, that he added onto the list. Then I have my poll workers and town meeting employees.
Is the town moderator paid now?
Yeah.
When was the last time the town moderator was paid?
I believe it was 3 or 4 years ago.
4 years ago?
Three, maybe.
Three,
four,
oh,
yeah.
Okay.
When we had all the budget cuts.
So it was in the 2013 fiscal year when we eliminated all stipends for boards and things, and the moderator was included in that.
Okay.
But I do feel that it's an important job, and
And that's for you, he requested it, so as a courtesy to him as an elected official, I included it. I know that it's gonna be subject of some discussion when you get to the warrant.
Okay.
Thanks, Carol.
Thanks, Carol. Any questions with that?
Were all these other positions always been paid?
Yes.
Any other questions?
I think this is a position, not that you don't deserve it, Carol, but I do think this was a rate increase. I think your current rate isn't that based on the current payroll reports.
Correct.
So that does show a wage increase in this budget.
It's a modest wage increase. The bulk of it is in the added hours.
No, it's a rate increase.
Yes, it's a modest rate increase. For the town clerk, unlike unelected officials, where you can make that decision after the town meeting, this board, and award those, town clerk salary must be established by the town meeting. So you need to have those monies in this budget. And again, we'll have that discussion when it comes to the
I got
warrant
you.
Itself.
Okay. Thanks, Doug.
Mm-hmm.
Expense budget?
And if you had to, could you do without the floating hours?
Yes, if I had to, but it would be nice to be able to keep the office.
So you're normally closed too, not unlike the deputy assessor?
I try to have my assistant work the full 35 hours, but I could possibly be moving to 38 hours.
How are things handled when you've been on vacation before?
They will usually, she'll fill in, or we'll have a little reduced hours.
Okay, all right, thank you.
But we're still maintaining a quality service to the community.
Absolutely.
Okay.
So employee support is all my dues and the associations that are required the contracting form.
And you're required to take education as well?
Yes.
And is that the international, are these all dues or are they?
The taught section are dues, and then the Massachusetts Town Clerks Conference, that is a conference.
That's a, okay.
Yeah.
All right.
And then
I just,
the one below is a conference.
Okay.
Yeah. Then that's for the moderator. That's something that he would have to attend.
Oh, the okay.
Yeah, that got added into my.
This is,
oh,
that's
support.
Moderate.
The
okay.
Bottom two are for the moderator.
So as a moderator normally attended those?
I am not sure what the past moderators
I don't know what your past moderator's done. This is a new moderator. I have found in the past that it is good for the moderators to stay connected, talk about how different towns do things, learn about how to deal with things, new statutes. This moderator's indicated an interest in some of that continuing education.
Thank you.
Given he's on meeting three, I think, with this upcoming annual town meeting.
I just have a quick question.
Yes.
He can't hear her.
He can't hear who?
She could speak, Carol.
Yeah.
She could speak a little louder.
You're so soft-spoken, Carol.
So soft-spoken, Carol, I'm sorry. Don't get embarrassed, it's okay. You're on TV. Yes.
On the moderator's annual conference, I see that the quantity is one, the cost is 50, yet the request is for 150.
I'll go back and check that.
Okay.
That's a good catch.
I didn't notice that.
Good catch, Gordon. Any other questions? Purchases and services.
Okay, so at the top I have the lease agreement for the copier and printer that I use. Then we have the ballots for when we have an election, the maintenance agreement, the laser fiche, the dog program, the Garden News advertisements. It's been suggested that I advertise the warrant in the Garden News as opposed to the Selectmen's office. So that's been added. And then the codification has been also added to the expense account.
Any questions with that? Yes.
Under codification, there's a footnote. It says that it's year two of a three-year contract with an annual service fee of $1,195.
Mm-hmm.
But the amount on the line item is $3,998. Was that for the 3 years?
No, that's for this year. It's a three-year program,
mm-hmm.
and we've paid, I believe it was $2,000 this year, and then next fiscal year it would be $3,998, and then I believe an additional that amount in the third year. But the annual fee every year after that will be $1,195.
Okay, so you broke it up into 3 years to cut down on the cost of it. Okay.
Yep.
Any other questions? Supplies?
So the office supplies are toners, folders. We have postage, which we do a lot with postage and mailing out ballots. And we have the census. And then the state requires that if someone doesn't return their census, that we need to send out a second reminder. So that's what the confirmation postcard is. And then we have the dog tags and the delinquent dog postcards that we also have to send out. And then the street list, printing the street list, has been added to my expense account.
Printed street list as in copies?
I'll be in charge of producing a book. Yep.
Okay. Did we do that last year, print a street list?
Normally the selectmen have been doing the street list, but in the last few years they have not had enough money, so I've just taken it upon myself to make up a street list book.
That's actually on a bylaw. Did you know that?
Mm-hmm. I didn't know that.
I forget exactly what it says, but we should be doing that. And
yeah,
I thought
right.
it was a
it
specific number of. I'm just saying.
Yeah, it's annual, isn't it? It's an annual report.
There's an annual town report too.
Right.
Yeah,
but
there's
annual street.
Then there's a street list.
There's a street list.
In the bylaw that.
Okay.
I was just letting you know.
Yep. Nope. That's good. Thanks for doing that. Any questions on the supplies?
Yep. Steph.
Yes. Steph, go ahead.
So this is where I saw one of you have envelopes with postage
yes.
and stamps because you need to do that to make sure that people, is that like for ballots, is that for absentee? Like what exactly is being mailed out that already has postage on it?
That would be any correspondence that I do with people with dog licenses. I have my envelopes with the stamps already on it. And if I have to add extra postage to mail back the dog licenses, that's what that postage.
Is there a reason that the residents can't do their own postage for dog licenses and that kind of stuff?
We ask that they do, but that doesn't always happen.
Jeez. You ask, okay, it's just in my head.
Yes.
Okay.
And also if we need to mail out death certificates or things like that.
Okay, I can see that.
Marriage licenses.
I actually used online to pay my excise tax. It was phenomenal. I'm sure you can do that with dog licenses too.
You can.
Not that I paid mine yet, but.
But sometimes you have to show her that there's a rabies.
Right.
Rabies
yep.
is up to date,
yep.
so it's hard to
but
do
I'm
that.
Just saying the online feature is nice, but, you know.
Can you upload?
I mean, I do so much through online banking that I'm, you know, I'm getting envelopes from even the light company, and mine's automatically comes out of my account, so I throw the envelope in the trash, which is a waste of money. So I'm just kind of saying, like, for most people, they just kind of use their own stamps and they,
well, business certificates, too, also.
Okay.
Out.
Okay. All right, thanks. I just wanted to know why.
Okay. Yes, Ms. Morrison.
We'll take those envelopes.
Don't what?
Save them up for Diana.
She'll
those
take
envelopes
the envelopes.
That come with your bills that you throw away?
Yes, ma'am.
Save them for us.
Why?
So she can mail them up.
Mail
so she can
them
use them.
Stuff.
Why?
We use them. The drivers take them on the vans, and when people do.
I'll start a collection for you of all my envelopes.
Yeah. The drivers get their donations, they send
oh, okay.
them in the envelope.
Be right. happy to buy you a box of envelopes, too, though.
Any other questions? Yes, Gordon.
If there was an area in your budget that needed to, if we had to make cuts, where would you say to look for that?
I feel that my budget is pretty tight as it is, but if I had to, I guess it would be the additional hours for when I'm on vacation.
And how will that impact you and the services you provide to the community?
The office would have to be closed.
Understood. Thank you. Yes.
Is there anything in your budget that's frivolous? Did you do it lightly?
No, I did not.
No, you didn't. So that's really not a fair question to ask, is it?
I think that in this time, all these questions are fair. They're just putting it forward.
No, you're making an assumption that people are presenting fluffed up budgets, and they're
not.
Not
at all.
No,
absolutely
not. I'm sorry if it comes across as that. That's not the intent here. The intent is to understand, like a few years back when we got into such a budget, you know, crisis, as to where the department heads, you know, said that this is a way that, you know, we might lose some services, but where we can continue to provide the necessities, and that's the purpose of the question.
Okay. Thank you.
And
Gordon.
I'm sorry if
Thanks.
Anyone intended it or took it any way different. That's not my intention.
Understood. Thank you, Gordon.
Thanks, Carol.
Thanks, Carol, so much. I appreciate it. Well done. Well spoken.
Softly.
Mr. Chairman, if
yes.
we could do police and fire, then these good folks, to the extent they want to, can leave, and I can take on treasurer, collector,
okay.
select board, and I'm going to be asking Doug to present. I think I warned you about this.
Mm-hmm.
The IT.
Information technology budget, is that okay with you?
Yeah,
okay, because you have that.
Yes,
all right, police, you want to do police first?
Yeah, in the package, just so you'll know, in the package that we gave out to everybody, I'll walk you through it at the end, but the last three pages that are paper-clipped together, the chief will be speaking to when he comes to the cruiser issue. The chief's budget starts on page 107.
Hi, Chief Bennett.
Good evening.
Chief, good to see you.
Nice to see you all.
All right, so let's talk personnel.
Personnel. We have the same personnel as last year, no increases. As you can see, it's spelled out exactly what their step is, whatever increase they have. You have your officers, your dispatches, part-time backfill, part-time dispatch backfill. You have all your benefits that are filled in. And the budget is according to everything they have by contract.
Pretty much solves that.
What was that?
I said it pretty much solves that. It's all under contract.
Yep.
Any specific questions on personnel?
How are police details paid for? Do they go as overtime?
Private contractor.
So it comes in and goes straight out from this?
Yes.
Under the FY18 administrator recommended, it's $1,160,000. The request was $1,188,000.
Mm-hmm.
And it says lump sum disallowed $4,760.
Well, there's two basic changes in there. One, you may recall that these budgets from the departments were submitted around 9 January, and that was right around the same time that the chief was departing for the National Academy. So he had submitted a budget based upon the possibility of the public safety administrator model that we'd been talking about, where he would have been basically covering both. So there's a large drop when that goes away and he comes back into his regular pay. The lump sum disallowed over the total budget is a little bit less than $5,000. It was about a 20-some thousand-dollar swing on public safety commissioner versus chief of police, and then the $5,000 over the course of the total budget.
So which figure are we looking at, the administrator requested number?
Subject to whatever the board instructs me to change it to, yes. Because at the end of the day, this is my recommendation to the board, and they will give me instructions as to what, if anything, they want changed in this. So the $1,160,000 is what's standing in front of the board right now.
Any other questions?
Yep.
Go ahead.
Do I not have a question?
Go
so
ahead.
With the, Julie had somewhat asked that, but I would like you to extend the answer. So with the disallowed of $4,760, and you said that this budget was based on, you know, all the contracts, really the only, are you going to, A, run out of money, and B, there's like money for, like there's just open, I'm sorry, I'm having a hard time. Unscheduled overtime, so you would just have to control your budget based
correct.
On that, correct?
We're operating that way currently because of the budget shortfall that we had
okay.
at the beginning of the year. So it can be held that way. You got to understand that by contract, there are so many sick days, so many
mm-hmm.
vacation
yep.
days, comp time. But if an employee doesn't take that time, then you'd be having a savings in it. However, if you don't fund for it, it's an unfunded liability, and if we come to it, then my budget would run short.
Right.
And this is still running short, one police officer, correct?
Correct.
Okay. I just really more want the public to understand that we are still short one police officer.
That
and that
correct.
Each year I've been on the board, I was really hoping that we would have the funds to be staffed fully because public safety is priority one, which includes this, the fire department, Board of Health, and highway. So I just
that's correct. If you wanted an explanation on how that affects the department, there are still shifts that run short. There are still shifts that there's only one officer working at a time.
And for how many hours is that, Chief?
It varies.
And how do you work domestics with that? Just curious, with one officer.
You hope that backup can arrive before something happens.
And your backup would be who?
Closest town that's to the incident.
Understood.
Thanks.
Thanks.
You're welcome.
Any questions with the personnel? No? Okay, let's move on to employees' report.
Okay, we have clothing allowance for our full part-time dispatch. We have part-time clothing allowance for police and dispatch. We have training registration fees. We have the chief's training and dues, PT stipends, AED stipends, EMD stipend, and longevity stipend.
All contracts, right, within the contracts?
Yes.
Chief, what is an AED and an EMD stipend?
AED is the advanced life support defibrillators that the officers carry. Was negotiated into the contract.
No, I'm just asking you to, I know, I just want other people to, so they have to have, if they have to use them, they're carried in your vehicles and...
It's their training, yes, it's their training for, pay for their training and that. And the EMD, state of Massachusetts 911 started to implement EMD 2 years ago, where it's a very in-depth call service now. When you go, when a rescue call comes in, they actually have a spreadsheet that they have to go through. It's monitored. We get checked by the state on whether or not we're doing our medical calls properly. So it's a lot more in-depth training than the dispatchers used to have in the past.
And EMD, that's emergency medical dispatching?
Yes.
Okay, so, and your cruisers are also equipped with first aid?
Yes.
And is that all up to date?
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
Any questions for the chief on this? None? Okay, moving on, chief. Purchases of services?
Animal control goes through our department. You have CJIS and NIC, which are criminal justice. That's how we determine warrants, things of that nature. You have Code Red, which many of you have witnessed in the past. We utilize it for emergencies. We have the printer copier service. The next one there is our phone system, in-house phone system. Those are the repeater lines that come from Baldenville to the tower so that we have radio communications throughout the town. And then we have our cell phones and our MTDs, which are our computers and laptops in the cruisers.
And those get updated annually, I would assume, right?
Yes.
What's IMC?
IMC is our computer software.
That's in the background. Mm-hmm. And the animal control is a contract, and...
That's with Winston, right?
Yes.
Well, I just don't see that in here, but how long is that? When does the contract expire?
I haven't seen it.
Do you know? Can you do...
We can find out.
I think it was a flat fee. Do you remember?
Yeah, I think it was a flat fee.
Yeah.
Was it annually? I honestly don't recall, so I think what we should look at that. Okay, thank you. So these costs on here are exact, like, well, because there's a lump sum disallowed of 212, so which part do you not pay? Because if these are real and you have to, which...
The monthly cost, you would hope that the cell phone MTDs might be a little less than a month.
Okay.
That's
like a guesstimation.
From the company, those are... Service contract.
So the only thing that is not are the cell phones and the MTDs?
Yes.
Okay.
Any questions about purchases?
Yeah, are the cell phones town cell phones, or are those personal cell phones that we're paying a reimbursement for them to use their cell phone?
They're department cell phones.
Okay. Do you know how many department cell phones there are?
Just all the full-time officers, 9, 1 in dispatch, 10, and a spare cell phone, so I would say 11 total.
Okay. And any full-time officer would have that at all times on them?
Yes.
Any other questions? Supplies?
Office supplies, we have... The office supplies, postage, ammunition, and taser cartridge. That's for training. Postage, you can see it's modest at 300. And office supplies, that's the entire building.
What kinds of things are included in your office supplies? Paper, pen, no.
Yeah, paper, pen.
$7,000 is not... That's why I'm asking if it was. It's a fairly significant amount, but is that like for a contract for No, it can't be a contractor, copier, or anything like that, right? No. So I'm just curious. Look at me, has all those papers all drawn out. I love you, Chief. I'm sorry, I need to put you on the spot, but...
No, it actually, office supplies, because when we switch to this, it's more, some things were put into office supplies that weren't, because we had dispatch, you had dispatch that had their own office supplies, and then you had PD that had their office supplies. So it's combined together of everything that's utilized in the station. So pretty much they just took the two budgets from last year and came up with this figure. Can I have, do I have an actual dollar amount of what it is? No, I do.
Can you just, do you have any detail for, I mean, again, office supplies to me is pens, papers, that's a lot of binder clips.
True.
I'm not trying to be sarcastic, but $7,000 is not small. So I'm just trying to figure out, like, okay, so they're gonna ask, where could you cut your budget? Well, I would cut your office supplies, but you can't do that if you need all that. But there's no background, there's no, I don't want to assume what office supplies are for police department and dispatch.
We're 9 months into the fiscal year, Chief. We can run...
Thank you.
A detailed report of the two...
Maybe departments? Maybe it's his coffee machine contract or something, you know?
Those were, that's what I was thinking, but it's not. It's okay, Chief, thank you.
Yeah, we'll figure it out.
Packaging notes.
All right, any other questions for supplies? Any other questions for supplies at this time?
10% of $7,000.
No, okay, moving on. Expense, other? Police and dispatch? We took notes, Chief, we'll look at that.
Okay. Building maintenance, equipment maintenance, and technology, and you had to agree with us. But we're gonna talk about that afterwards.
Yes.
So equipment maintenance would be like a maintenance contract, or...
No, that's having money in our account in case something breaks down. One dispatch console is over, well, we just upgraded the two of them, that was to the tune of $95,000. One radio, one portable radio is over $1,000.
Okay.
We just had, we're having issues with the volume controls, or the volume issue with the main console. We had two technicians in, one service call was $1,000. So $15,000 to have in reserve just in case is not an astronomical amount.
Now, do you have a contract with that company? Technology?
Technology is computers, software, screens, towers, laptops, anything that we have to replace on that side of it.
Okay, so you have tough books in your cruisers?
Yeah.
Okay,
digital
gotcha.
Cameras, that's all. That's all.
Yes.
Where is your internet? Is that in?
Would that be technology?
Wait, no, that would have, that could have been under office supplies, I wasn't sure. I did some.
Well, in the technology budget, there is six internets, but there's no detail behind what six buildings it is, what department it is, what speeds it is.
Right, yeah.
Yeah.
We're currently working with Montalbano Services, and we are going to start utilizing the fiber optic line in town.
Okay.
We are going to have a closed network between police, fire in town, police in Phillipston, and fire in Phillipston.
Right.
We'll have a closed circuit. The state requires that our circuit is closed for security reasons, for CGIS. So we're in the process of doing that right now. A lot of that is funded by grant money.
Okay.
So some of that technology falls under that also.
All right.
We'll double check, Julie, and make sure that's...
That would be good. That'd be safer for you guys.
Great. because currently the fiber that the state put through can only be used for interconnecting the buildings. You can't really get to the outside over the fiber network.
Right.
So using it for the, what you're getting ready to do is outstanding. We could use it here for interconnectivity, like connecting here with Town Hall and the Senior Center and the library. We could use that fiber for interconnecting, but you can't go outside yet.
The interconnection would be great.
Yeah, absolutely.
On one server capability.
If anyone is, I believe, I don't know if it was Mass Broadband, they're the ones that started the whole thing, but the third-party provider, don't get scared. They did just file bankruptcy.
Right.
But it was just for restructuring purposes. That's all it is. We had them out.
Okay.
That was one of our concerns, but no, it's just a restructure.
Okay. Yeah, because it used to be Axie, or now I think it's KTC or something.
Correct.
Yeah.
And they don't have to pay anybody if it's beat it.
Carter, do you want me to?
If you would, please, as I said, when we gave you this package earlier, I'm sorry, Gordon, Mr. Chairman.
Yes.
Just my question on, you know, if cuts had to be made, where, and a little bit different, because we definitely have contracted items in here. What items, you know, are the, what pages here were the contracted items, which we know that we were obligated to?
Most everything in this is contracted items. If you had to ask me where I was going to, where I would recommend cuts, I would not answer that question. I would say, tell me how much money I have to cut, and I'll make that decision when it comes down to it.
Good answer.
Thank you.
Chief, with regards to, like, the console repair, it's, you know, it's up close to six-figure repair and stuff.
Yes.
Is that stuff, is that what the 911 grant covers a lot of that, or is that...
Yes.
Like that clear though.
Mr. Bennett, you're correct. Some of that money can go towards that. When I write up one of the grants, I look at what the needs are of all the communities with dispatch center. We're working on getting the fire department. Chief Dickey was just in the station today for over an hour and a half. I'm going to utilize that grant to update his software so that the fire department can be brought up to speed. I'm also writing another grant to get him the full IMC software that we use, but on the fire side. Some of that will be covered from a developmental grant. Some of that will be covered from the 911 grant. The only problem, and I explained this to you before, and when Mr. Markle was here, that funding source was cut when I became chief. It was not available. And if we were operating under the budget that they had proposed at that time, we would have ran out of money. So it's a tough thing. You know that there's a lump of some money there, but you don't know if you're going to get it because you don't know what's going to happen with the state.
I just want that to get out there because, like I said, we talked and you explained it. You know, everybody says, oh, it's 111 or 120 or whatever.
Right.
It's not always
it varies.
There. And
it varies. It can go either way. It goes equipment. It could go personnel. It can go putting money into the station.
Hence why the Board of Selectmen voted for a level fund. Using grant money is not level funding.
Do you want to move on to the cruiser?
Absolutely. Thanks, Chief.
So on that package we gave everybody, the very last three pages, you'll see an Excel spreadsheet that looks like this. And that has the current cruiser fleet, and the chief can speak to his needs for that.
You want to ask a question?
Yep, I'll ask at the end. Thank
okay.
you.
Sorry.
That's okay.
Okay, so fortunately, we were able to, I was approached by someone from the light department, a board member who asked if the PD needed anything, and at that time I said no, we're operating fairly well. And then as a few months went by, we started to witness problems with our cruiser fleet. So I went back to the individual that approached me and I said, if there's anything you could get us, I could use a new cruiser. They brought it to their board. They thought it was a
new cruiser?
Yes.
Oh.
They brought it to their board. They said it was a worthwhile project that they would like to undertake, so they agreed to purchase a new cruiser. That cruiser is replacing a 2010 Ford Crown Vic that has over 160,000 miles on it. The air conditioning unit in that car has cost us well over $6,000 in the time that we've had it. It's the car, if you talk to the highway mechanic, is in dire needs to be replaced. Unfortunately, unlike the highway department or some of the other departments, our vehicles run 24/7, 7 days a week, snow, sleet, it doesn't matter. So I know that some cars can go up over mileage. People have cars that can go to 250,000 miles, but they don't drive them like a Lion Cruiser is driven. So our fleet was looking pretty good, and just last week I was informed by the highway mechanic that C10, which is a Ford Explorer, purchased the same year with 117,000 miles on it, has a blown in engine. It needs to be replaced. You're talking a substantial amount of money. So now we're down another vehicle.
Would it be advantageous to replace the engine in that or just get a new vehicle?
I wouldn't.
You're looking at $5,000 plus or minus.
Yeah.
By the time you buy all the parts, then you got to invest the mechanic's time in it. And if we're able to acquire the new cruiser this year, I mean, it really comes down to a choice between C10 and 11, because the Chief's car 11 has some issues as well.
Yes. And speaking to, going back to the question, replace it, Mr. Bennett was on the board at the time, I believe, and we entertained rebuilding two cruisers, which was a disaster. We thought it was going to be a good idea when we did it, and the cars just ended up costing us so much money in the long run.
Okay.
I wouldn't recommend replacing the engine. If the vehicle only had 50,000 miles on it, and you blew the engine, it might be worth it.
I got you, Chief. No, I'm just curious.
So the fleet is falling apart rather quickly. I talked to Mr. Terrazini, 11. We had to put a substantial amount of money into that. He asked if that car could make it. I said we could keep 11 running, hopefully to, you know, special meeting. If we get free cash available, we'll be able to replace that one. And then the fleet would actually be in decent shape until we have to replace A9, which also has 112,000 miles on it, but it's driven by the SRO, so we would be able to limp that vehicle for another year. Any questions on that? So by going down a car, it only enhances the amount of miles that are going to be put on a vehicle. Because we try to schedule the vehicles out so that if they're spaced for drivers, so that we're not putting excessive amount, well, we are, but we're trying to keep it down.
Right.
So if we get down a car, that means that car has to be driven that much more.
Understood. Gordon, what do you have?
Where are these on our capital planning schedule, these vehicles? Does anybody know? Have capital planning look at these vehicles?
Yeah, I don't have the schedule, or unless it's in here, I don't have the schedule in front of me. I do know we...
They're on the list.
I did it.
Yeah, we did have one on the list.
I think there was one, and I notified all the departments, Doug, that I didn't think were on the... hadn't submitted this year, so we could circle back and meet with you all.
Yeah, they, it was
I
on
I know that the Chief did submit the one cruiser. And I'm looking at page 351. And it called for the, for a 2011 a Crown Vic to be replaced with the Explorer. And that's on page 351.
Chief, how long should a, what's the standard amount of time? I mean, 2007 to 2017 is 10 years. Obviously, we can do the math, but what is the standard amount of time that a police vehicle should be replaced or driven for? Is it the amount of miles? Is it what you do? Is it
the roads we have?
I'm sorry, Beth?
Look at the roads we have.
Generally, with the amount of miles that we're putting on a vehicle, it should be rotated out every 4 years.
4 years, okay.
So on the fifth year, they should be coming out of the rotation. That not only benefits the town, but the department, because now the department's not running a vehicle with such high mileage, the maintenance is gonna be kept down. And then in town, we have a history until now, because vehicles have been so poor, but we had a history of passing down the vehicles to other town departments. Well, Mr. Capelis can attest that we passed one down and lasted him all of 3 months.
Easy, yeah, if that.
Well, I think it's kind of a shame that we're putting police officers in cars that are subpar, period.
Yeah.
That's really not helping with public safety. I'm just making a comment to the chief in general. I just don't, I didn't realize.
No, I agree with you. I think it's part of their equipment. Just like their duty belt, you know, they got their handcuffs, their weapon.
Like their bulletproof vest.
That bulletproof vest, that they can't get to the call, then how good are they? If that vehicle breaks down, how good are you?
That's terrible.
You know what I'm saying?
Correct.
Yes, Gordon?
It was good to see these on the capital planning, and I saw that there's others on there as well.
Yes.
And with what the information has been provided, you know, that basically we should be seeing two vehicles every year on the capital plan.
Yes.
In order to maintain the level of service that's needed. And I don't know if that's gotten that far out yet, but you know that we need to start getting those on the longer range planning.
That's why when we talked, at least when Chief and I talked, I really pushed for the fact that that cruiser should be on the budget every single year. At least one cruiser should be on the budget. But I mean, obviously you're right, two should be the adequate amount. That way he has a good rotation. But for the longest time he was told not to put any vehicles on. But again, it's part of his equipment. It's like part of the, it's like a bulletproof vest. Or their weapon or ammunition for training. I mean, that vehicle is the most, I would say more important, because if you can't get there, you can't do the, you can't.
They're really fit, they're gonna run.
No, they're not gonna run, not that far. They could though, they could.
So
Are you prepared to like, so what's the plan now, Mr. Tenzini?
We have, when we go through the set of budget revisions that we're proposing, the bad news is I made a mistake in the budget, in one account. The good news is it was in our favor. It was a $15,000 error in the calculation that neither I nor anyone else had caught. But that will allow us to enter into a 3-year lease and acquire the cruiser now that we weren't able to get it in the other avenue.
Okay.
So then we'll deal with the second 2011 vehicle at the fall town meeting.
Okay. How do you feel about leasing?
I'm not opposed to it. The only, I know that before in the past, the only reason why the board was against it was because it's guaranteed money that has to be put into the budget. Whereas if you buy the vehicle, it's the one-time expense and then you don't have to worry about it again.
That's true. Is there, go ahead, no, I'm sorry, go ahead.
So, is there a reason that we can't do four? I mean, the payment is a little bit less. You're not talking about, I mean, 3 years is nice, but could we do four? Would that be reasonable or not reasonable? I'm asking you as a police officer, not as an administrator. Is 4 years okay?
Four would be an acceptable lease, because if we were going to rotate the vehicle out on the fifth year, that would work right into what I...
So if we had a capital improvement budget that was done, you know... First, you need money in stabilization. I need money in a capital improvement. And if you have that list, which is in here, and you say, so I did call you about this, and thank you for taking my call. So it's a matter of, okay, so 4 years would be roughly $12,000. So if we said, you know, if we ran out of money, where's Chief gonna cut out of his budget? And in that's a lot of money. So we have to make sure that we have the money each year. So we have a lease payment, then we have a lease payment, and that should be part of the capital budget.
Capital
Am I saying
plan.
That right?
Well, it goes into his operating budget, just
but
as
we have
the
to
ambulance
say,
does.
Just because it's on the capital plan doesn't mean it has to be funded from...
I mean, a lease is a funding mechanism. If you had $45,000 in cash, or excuse me, $42,000 in cash, I would say just buy it. But at this point in the budget process, subject to any changes you give me, there isn't $42,000 there. So the fallback position becomes the lease. And the 3-year lease was proposed because we could afford it, and it's a little bit less interest. If you wanted to look at the 4-year, that's obviously a financing decision, and you could all do that. That's right. Certainly doable. You can even, if you got $15,000 this year, you can even pay $3,000 down because you want to have the 4-year lease figure.
Understood.
So it's really, however you want to do it. I
guess my concern with purchasing outright is that 10 years later, we would have that vehicle still. And we're not in that rotation, and this would be a way to, you would have the vehicle for 3 or 4 years, and you turn it back in, and you get a new, and it's already in that rotation.
If you can build into your budget, I do think you will stretch to build 4-year cycles, 2 cruisers a year, given all the other capital needs that the community has.
Chief, do they have a mileage on those as well in the lease? Is it a mileage?
No. Usually it's covered by a warranty, 100,000 miles.
So there's no mileage on it.
And these aren't the types of leases like you would buy on a personal car. No. These are dollar buyout leases.
Right.
So after the 3 years or 4 years, you still own the car.
Right.
Yes.
I understand. Gordon?
No. I've never been a big fan of financing items. And, you know, basically, will cost the town more in the long run. I look at financing as an emergency type thing. You know, when you're leasing a vehicle, you're paying that finance. It's going to cost the town more in the end. You know, maybe we have to do it at this point, but it's going to make it that much harder for us to get ourselves out of the hole because now we're also paying interest. So if we can find a way to finance things without taking out loans or leases, it's going to get the town back onto its feet faster than if we keep taking out more loans.
Yeah, unfortunately, we're in a situation right now, as you can see, that we need that piece of equipment now for public safety, and that takes priority over anything else, as far as I'm concerned. I don't know if fellow board members think, but that's my concern. If the police officer can't get to where he needs to get to, or that vehicle that he's in breaks down, I'll be very disappointed. And if that causes somebody to be hurt, or somebody loss of life, guess who becomes responsible and liable?
We do.
Right. The town of Templeton. So this thing is bigger than what people really think it is. We need these access and these vehicles. And you're right, we should, if we had the finances to buy it outright, then we should. That's why it was in his budget. But obviously we didn't have the funding this year, so what's the next best opportunity? Is that at this point is to lease it for right now. And then hopefully with all the input of the selectmen, we can budget that next year. And hopefully, you know, either purchase, because it's a purchase lease, right, Chief? It's a purchase lease?
Correct.
I mean, say year two, we get the money, maybe we can purchase it at that point for a lesser amount of money.
That's correct.
And something along those lines.
There's no penalties.
You know what I'm saying? I mean, at least for now. I mean.
They can't do that, so.
Yes, sir.
You do a lease. Do they take care of the repairs for the car?
Yeah, it's under warranty.
It would be under warranty.
Okay. And is there any particular reason why you pick a Ford rather than some other type of make of car?
We've had the other vehicles before. We weren't satisfied with their capabilities.
Which one do you have?
We've had all of them. We've had Chevy, we've had Dodge, we've had
Toyota.
Don't make it.
Don't make it.
Huh? Don't make it. Kelly, you had a question?
Well, I just wanted to bring up that about the repairs, because right now we're budgeting close to $100,000 for maintenance and repairs, you know. And if
that's for the town, right?
Right, and if we lease a police car and we don't have to worry about that maintenance and repairs, yes, we might be paying a little extra in interest, but you can take quite a bit of money because we're not constantly trying to maintain these vehicles and dump money and dump money and dump money in.
That's good, okay. Any other questions for the chief?
I just wanted to say, you know, and I did send John, thought that the light and water department, I wanted to thank them for all that they have done for us and that they were going to purchase, that they are purchasing a vehicle for you, and that is scheduled for delivery. So I think that was great.
If I could, I went back and double checked my records. Just to touch on the line item, because it's bothering me, and I apologize for the office supplies. That back in 2013, 2014, office supplies were $4,400. For our budget, for PD, and $3,400 for dispatch.
$4,400 and $3,400.
So that number has not increased, and it's actually gone down since 2013, 2014, and if you look back at the money that we've turned in over those years, I believe it was less than $500.
I got Kelly back there shaking her head, so. Thanks, Chief. Any
so
other
need,
questions?
Yes, I need to go backwards because we moved on. So for the dispatch, we dispatch with Phillipsen, correct?
Correct.
Do they pay a fee
they
to
do.
The town of Templeton?
They
and
do.
What, do you know what the amount of that is? Because
That amount last year was 54,000 and some change. I sent them a letter halfway or 4 months into the fiscal year last year, indicating that it would increase to $60,000 this year, and that it would increase every year until it's at the appropriate amount, which would be the agreement says they would pay for one full-time dispatcher. I sat down when I came back from DNA and figured that out, and it's roughly 67,000 and some change, just under 68 would be the full cost for a dispatcher. I cannot answer your question of why it hadn't increased over those years. As soon as, once I became chief, I looked at it and I went to address it.
And could I see that agreement that you have with Phillipsen?
Yes.
Thank you. Could you email that to me or to the rest of the board too?
That'd be great.
I would like to see that. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. I'd like to see it.
On page 14 of your budget book, you'll see that we've carried $65,000 for the coming fiscal year.
Okay, good.
Did I miss that?
No, no problem. I just want you to.
Okay.
Did you have a question, Kate?
So many numbers.
Well, I did, but you've called on five people since I've initially put my hand up.
I'm sorry, I missed you. I apologize.
All right. But I'm taking the notes. You understand I am the scribe, so I do need. I notice you have three cars listed under your long-range plans. How many vehicles do you have, in fact, in your fleet?
The number that's on that piece of paper right there, ma'am.
Did you get this from?
It's in the in the pile.
Right in the pile.
Eight
no.
Vehicles. Oh,
there's
all
eight
right.
Vehicles. You have eight.
Okay, you have eight.
That includes your car.
That's correct.
So what's the question, Kate?
Oh, forget it. I'm too tired at this point.
Okay. Understood. Yes.
Okay. To get back to the amount of from dispatch from Phillipsen.
Yes.
You've increased it to 60,000 for FY18?
Correct.
And you have 65 in the budget? Okay.
There was an agreement we sent. We're going to be sitting down with them again. I spoke with Chief Dodge, and they're in the budget process also, and we're going to finalize the actual amount. But I had sent a letter stating that it would increase to 60.
Okay.
So it's guaranteed that, and then whatever.
And then what? Okay.
Yeah.
The other question that I had was, I just wanted to be clear.
Yes.
So C10. No, 10 is going to be replaced with a brand new vehicle.
Yes.
From money from the light company. C10 is the one we're talking about, a lease, whether it's 3 or 4 years.
Correct. That's
okay.
The loan engine. All
right. I just wanted to make sure.
We're currently down at this time two vehicles.
Mm-hmm.
They're off. They're not in the fleet.
Because you should have 10 vehicles total. 10 total.
No, what, no, no.
Two
eight,
of his eight
two,
are down.
Two of the eight are down. We're down to six right now.
Okay, I got you.
All right.
And if we just back up a little bit, the town has not bought a vehicle for the police department since 2011.
And if I may, Chief, actually two out of your seven vehicles are down because one of the vehicles is an unmarked surveillance.
That's correct.
Vehicle.
That was purchased.
That is not suitable for frontline
no,
police.
No, that was
work.
Purchased with asset forfeiture money from the district attorney's office.
That was the Chevy?
The Impala.
Yeah.
Yes.
Is that dead? Is it still drivable or no?
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
But it's not
suitable. It's not a cruiser.
I understood.
Yeah.
Understood. There's no lights in it?
No. Well, no, there's lights, but it's not.
I got you.
You're not chasing anybody with it.
You're not chasing anybody down?
No.
Okay, I got you. So you're still down two?
Yes.
So, okay. Any other questions for the chief?
Sorry if it felt like I grilled you.
No. I feel bad I didn't have the answer to the officer's points, but.
Okay, no questions? No other questions? No?
Doesn't feel the same on the other side of the table.
Thanks. Thanks, chief. I appreciate it. Keep us safe.
Actually, I think that rather than turning to your budget book, in the packet I gave you, you're gonna find a clip that was the second set of papers. This is Chief Dickey. His first,
Really?
His first stage center appearance here tonight. After the chief was appointed, I asked him to take the request of the department and to review it, since he had not been the one who submitted the original. So in that package, yes, that's, Gordon, you've got it right there. It's paperclip.
Hello, Chief Dickey.
Okay.
It's lovely to say that.
Chief, it's good to see you.
So his first comment to me in reaction to the draft budget was that he thought the initial request from the acting chief was low, was off the mark in terms of what we would have to pay to recruit firefighter EMTs. So when you look at page 120B of this packet, you'll see the little wage study that he so nicely put together for me. And he felt that the shifts, the 42.5 hours, were insufficient. So he went through and did some revisions. And with that, Chief, if you want to walk folks through the package.
Good evening. Like Carter said, I took a look at this after the appointment, so I really haven't had a lot of time. But talking with my medics, talking with my EMS director, and with Carter, I went through the wages and to try to find the median wage so that we could attract good quality paramedic firefighters. So with that, I came up with the wage of $22 an hour that I was hoping to pay my firefighter medics. With that, Carter had asked for originally budgeted for a 42-hour week. Paramedics in this area, paramedic firefighters, really, most of them work 24-hour shifts. We're looking at 16-hour shifts with our agreement with Office of Emergency Management Services at the state level for our ALS licensing. Based on that, and we have, right now we're having to do the 16 hours starting Saturday, I tried to rework the budget for 16-hour shifts, so putting people on for 48, the full-timer on for 48 hours a week, and then using per diem firefighters, firefighter medics. After that, still trying to keep our coverage at the 16-hour week with people in the stations, and then anything above and beyond that, if we have call medics, we would try to get even more hours to be covering all the calls that we need to cover. So as Carter said, I did a wage survey. I did all the towns that are the comparable towns that he gave me to list from, and I went above and beyond that, and I really went to our area towns as well and looked at everybody, and you can see that the median wage is $21.79 for medics in the area, and the average, both the high and the low, is $22.18. So I really thought the 22 was fair. Try to attract good quality employees.
Now, how much is this tax dollars versus ambulance receipts receivable? Have you broken that down?
The total budget for the department is proposed to be, just bear with me one moment,
yep,
please, because we've gone back through this, $565,251. Now, do remember that is exclusive of all the benefits, which are in another unit completely.
Right.
And we're projecting revenues next year of $325,000. We're actually projecting $525,000. But when we laid out the revenue projections, mm-hmm. we said we were going to grow into that over, constantly chasing it over 3 years so that we weren't overestimating. Exclusive of benefits, we're looking at supporting somewheres of about 60% of the department on the medical side, which is fairly consistent with the call volumes. And then okay. the benefits are all outside of that.
Okay. All right.
So also built into the budget, because when we started our ALS, we didn't start it during the budget time. You know, July 1 would have been a great time to start, but a past chief pulled the trigger and we started in April. So with this budget also is two more people, because during the next fiscal year, we're going to go from the 16 hours we're trying to start covering now
to 24,
to 24 hour coverage. So the last portion of the year, we have two more firefighter medics built into that to increase our coverage to that 24 hours.
How many full-time staff would you need to operate the ambulance 24/7?
How many full-time? Besides mm-hmm. myself, I would need at least six.
Okay. How many does Winchington have at this point?
Winchington has six on shifts, and they have one days.
Okay, sure.
Well.
Okay.
Besides the chief.
So obviously, you're putting together a 5-year plan, I would assume, or at least a good 4-3-year plan, which is going to include not only the budgetary economical response for the personnel, but the safety and the utilization of the equipment.
Correct.
Okay.
How many full-time people are the fire department ambulance currently have?
Currently, right now, you have myself, and we have one other person that's full-time, and we staff with per diems and call personnel after that.
So two full-time and the rest are per diem and call?
Yes.
They have do you still utilize the FTE program for right now?
It
wasn't either, because I don't like it. I personally don't like it.
Could we possibly not use that terminology anymore?
I do not use the FTE or full-time equivalent anymore.
Okay.
So those hours are filled with either per diem, paramedic, firefighters,
yep.
paramedics, or our call staff. It's still hours that we have to be staffed.
Right.
We're not using full-time equivalent anymore.
Okay, so we're still going to bring potentially one full-time firefighter paramedic on, like, now, right?
Yes.
Okay.
So can you explain, a lot of things to look at, but there's no, so you would be staffed in 2018 with you and two other, like a full-time firefighter paramedic, and then a full, like, can you tell me what that would look like?
Yeah, besides myself, there would be two full-time employees.
Okay, and that is because now per the agreement for ALS, each year or every so many, you have to.
The agreement with ALS, and I didn't, today being my first day in the office, did not get a chance to find the packet and examine it myself.
Yeah.
The agreement that my understanding is we had a 3-year plan
mm-hmm.
to go to 24-hour coverage. The first year, which we just finished, was going to be 8 hours a day, and that was designed around the last fire chief. Then, starting April 1st of this year, so 16. Just this past Saturday, we were supposed to move to 16 hours of coverage, and then
a day.
And then next April, we're going to move to 24 hours.
Okay.
And what's your personnel activation plan? What's your personnel plan? So you got, we got to hire at least one more now, because you have one of the staff. And I believe you also requested a part-time person that's gonna do payroll and billing for Coastal, is that correct?
The part-time, the admin assistant, yes, would be working on, working with payroll, would be working on the billing, processing to get to Coastal in a timely manner.
Right.
They would be helping with the scheduling of personnel and for inspections for the department.
Okay, 'cause this will also decrease, 'cause obviously with billing to Coastal, they like it to be right away. 'Cause I know we've lost funding because billing wasn't done appropriately or correctly. So obviously the town lost money because of that, or because of insurance companies.
I've never been advised that we've lost money or nothing's been paid, it's never been.
Yeah, there's a list somewhere of insurance companies that haven't paid because it wasn't done in a timely fashion. I don't know where it is, but we're supposed to approve that as Selectmen, I believe.
That's not necessarily from a timely manner, that's just stuff that hasn't been paid for one reason or another.
Oh, is that what it is? Okay. I just wanna make sure everybody's clear. Yes, Gordon?
I know some asterisks here on the 121C page, but I don't see a footnote to go with them. So I'm just curious, I see.
It's on the bottom, it says original budget was 42.5 hours.
Oh, I didn't see it there.
And then EMT budget, Ridge employees was 90%, with one asterisk.
I see it there now, I missed seeing it.
Okay.
And currently you staff mostly with call volunteers. Basically, they're on call, they get paid when they come. How is that staffing? Are you short, or do you have, is this based on, I guess my question is this based on what you would like to have available, or based on the current people you currently have available, and are you looking for more volunteers?
We are looking for more. For our basic EMTs, we have a good complement of EMTs right now. Our paramedics, we are short on paramedics, and we are currently looking for more paramedics.
So is this number based on filling those call positions, or?
These numbers are based on hours, not positions, 'cause a call firefighter or a call EMT or medic doesn't get paid anything unless they show up. So I could have 30 people that, if we're not getting them scheduled, 'cause they're working other places, and maybe this month they didn't get any hours, they don't cost anything at that point in time.
Right.
But the other people that are getting the hours.
So you schedule people to be on call certain hours?
It's, the paramedics are gonna be in the station for the 16 hours. The other people, we get them to sign up to be on call.
Yeah, in the area?
Yes.
Yeah, okay. And you're short on people being able to sign up for some of those shifts right now, is what you're saying, some of them?
For the basics, we're restructuring right now, and this is day one in the office for me. I haven't even met with my people in my current role yet to go over where we're headed.
Yes, Ben?
Who's gonna do your training? Do you guys have to have training as you go along? I know Ray used to do that.
Ray did not do the training.
He didn't do that?
No, my EMS captain, my EMS director, Peter Leighton, for the ambulance side, he has, since he's been aboard here for a few years, he's been in charge of training, and he's taught probably about 80% of it. A lot of our training is done internally through him teaching it, but we do have other classes that are state mandated classes that we can't teach internally, so we hire out for that.
Okay.
And they're all quoted by OEMS, so everybody gets their OEMS credits through here when he registers the classes?
We do so much training. Our training standards for our department are so much higher than other departments, because we are looking for the best responders that we can get, the best training for them. Our people have no trouble making their minimum hours to get their training.
And I believe that's 24, right, now? 'Cause you guys are going to the national registry standard?
It's there's 26 national hours, it's almost like a refresher, but they don't call it that anymore.
Right, right.
And then there's another 20 besides, it's like 48 or 50 hours total that you need. And that's just to maintain the basic. Paramedics need more than that, that doesn't include our CPR training and things like that.
Okay. And
I know that you get a lot of calls, like if somebody falls out of bed and they need to get picked up. Are you gonna, do you really think that you're gonna have enough calls? Because you can bill an insurance company, that doesn't mean they're gonna pay you what you bill them. Are you gonna be able to swing this thing, do you think?
So far, we have been able to, and that's the plan right now.
Yeah, but you're bringing more people on.
But again, if they're not working, they're really not costing us.
I see.
And we also increased the ambulance rate significantly, which was also a huge impact to the community, because we were charging basic rates for ALS service, which was not good for the department or for the community. So in most communities, the insurance companies typically pay almost 50% of what's projected. So if we send a bill for $1,000, we know we're probably going to get $500 of that. And so it's a good call for the increasing the billing. You have anything else?
Your administrative assistant, is that going to be civilian now and not officer?
Yes.
I think it would have been helpful.
Yes.
To have, I've seen the coastal reports, but you think that...
How was it?
People, well, I've seen them because I've looked them all over,
yeah.
So you can see what was taken in and what we're still waiting for and what, you know, so to have, I have them somewhere, thank you. And that just would have, it's kind of hard to look at something that's anticipated if you don't see what we've gotten and you don't see what we've changed for, you know, rates and fees.
So so the appropriation for ambulance receipts receivables for next year, what do you say was going to be?
325.
No, what's the appropriation going to be?
Oh, 325.
325.
325. So if your budget's $500,000, say, 325 is going to come from ambulance receipts receivable, the other portion of that's going to come from taxation dollars.
Correct.
Is that a fair statement? Okay.
And Diane, you're looking at the coastal reports right now. That stuff just went into effect January. You're not seeing increases yet. It takes time.
And that's fine. I'm just saying that background. It's it's easier to see background. And I think the only other thing is there have been varying ways that because we're combining all this now in the general fund so that it can be, because it's really hard to say who's being paid for fire, who's being paid for paramedic, but when I've looked through the warrants through the years, they've been worded differently. And this was supposed to be an account that paid for the ambulance, and then to have any monies left over would fund a new ambulance, a new piece of fire apparatus, and so on and so forth, which I believe will still be done. But the monies are supposed to be kept in there. But each warrant was written not quite the same way. So I think that there are definitely have been questions of how was that money supposed to be spent. Period. So I think that's something that needs to be looked at.
Sure, we can do that.
Okay. I just want to be clear with the public.
Yeah.
That's all. You know where we're at with that.
I mean, all revenues will go into the reserved for appropriation account.
Mm-hmm.
Period. And then annually, you will determine how much is appropriate to transfer out of that to help support the department's budget. And if we build this up, remember, you started spending this very same year you made the switch.
Yep.
Normally, you would wait 1 year so that you have a balance to be appropriate. So we think you're going to get about $525 a year, give or take. And by taking 325, if this works out, you'll have 100 and change. And as you build that up, you will be building that reserve over time. And you will be able to get out of the business of leasing that ambulance and paying cash for it.
Right.
With that reserve that's in that account.
Okay,
I'm having a hard time seeing that. But I think that at this moment, when you want to look at, you've said before, we can't really see last year's because we're doing it different. And then there's this year's. And we know that through going to ALS, we have to meet a certain requirement. Next year would be at the 24 hours. It would be really nice to see like how much more this budget's going to be.
Right.
It's hard for me to make a decision in a bubble for this particular budget. I think you've done a great job. I think what I looked at so far
was good, but again, you have to visualize it.
Yeah, it'll be another 100,000 with two additional employees at 54,912. So that's what you're looking at for next year, an additional $100,000 plus equipment.
Plus the benefits.
Plus the benefits, which is about 20, you know, I'd say about 18,000 apiece, 15,000 apiece for benefits. So you'll be.
When you have time.
You'll be looking at put 130,000 plus probably.
130 to 150.
Yep.
And that includes benefits?
Yes.
But the benefit portion of it, well, anyway, I'm not going to belabor the point. I'll have to look at it.
It's in another budget, it's the problem.
Right, exactly.
If you want to convert to a program budget, you can do it, but it takes a lot of time and energy, and I will tell you that it really messes things up towards the end of the year when you have somebody who's on a single plan and converts to a family plan. It puts the
so the benefits come out of taxation.
Mm-hmm.
That's all.
Yep. So my next question would be, Mr. Tanzini, so obviously the budget that's here is obviously different from the budget that's in the supplement. So how is that going to affect the total overset budget at this point?
Doesn't.
Okay.
The chief had the chief asked for more money in personnel, which was extremely easy to accommodate because it was his job to figure out how to cut the balance of it to absorb the personnel.
Okay.
So I had the easy part of the chore.
Understood. So you're not going to, any question with personnel at this point?
No, yes. We're going through each section.
Yes, we are. Yes, Jeff.
Just a comment on the, with regards to your concern about lost revenue and timely billing and stuff. And back a number of years, I think it was it 11 or 12? The Board of Selectmen, the chief, fire chief came before us. The ambulance billing goes out and the insurance company pays whatever they're going to pay, and then the other part goes on the patient, the people who called. And there was a chunk of money, it was six figures, I think, close to it, that they thought was uncollectible due to different circumstances. You know, somebody, you can go to somebody and say, hey, you got to pay this? Well, I got no heat or
right,
any heat.
Right.
So the Board of Selectmen voted to just write that fund off. And that,
right.
It was loss of revenue to the town, but again, you're thinking of the residents, you know, do you make the choice you eat or pay this insurance, you know, this money to the ambulance service? So that was one incident that I recall of, like, lost revenue to the town.
Right.
But it wasn't due to the billing or a timely receipt or anything. It was all done. We just collected what the insurance company paid, and
the others was we
could not, just could not pay it.
And since then, there's new, I don't remember the days and everything. I have to sit down with Coastal.
Right.
But the bills go out, and I don't remember if it's 60 or 90 days they have to pay. You know, if it's not paid in a certain amount of time, then it gets kicked over to a collection agency now.
Okay.
And then it goes after, the collection agency goes after it, and anything after that is deemed not collectible is supposed to come to the board.
For non-retrieval
funds. I believe once a year.
Yes.
To develop a formal write-off.
So that way it doesn't look like it's anticipated money coming in anymore, because
right.
Really at that point it's uncollectible.
Right, and you know as well as I do, the HMO and the PPOs and Medicare and Medicaid all have selected rates anyways for the ambulance rides, regardless of what we bill. Yes.
And just so the board will understand, that 525 we estimated as revenue was not at 100% of the billing rates.
Right.
It was closer to about 46% because we analyzed the collection rates over the last 3 years and used that actual
Understood.
Collection rate against your new revenue stream.
That's good. That's good planning.
I was on the board then, Jeff, so that had to have been on 23rd, 4th. Yeah, I remember him coming before us, but that's never happened again. So whatever's sitting out there has just...
It was either 2012 or 2013.
I was on the board then, or I came to a meeting
because
when
that it
happened.
It was the first year that Chief LaPorte was in that got addressed.
Yeah, I know there's a list because I've seen it. Yes, Kelly.
Yeah, it was like $104,000.
Yes.
It was.
Like
yeah, I
yeah.
saw it. There was the most current list that the acting chief had.
But that's not ever been written off again.
No, nothing's been come to the board.
No.
Okay. Right. There's been two other write-offs since then, but they weren't very much.
Any other questions or concerns concerning this with the chief on personnel? No, moving on to employee support.
Okay, employee support is, a lot of the here is our firefighting gear and so forth. In this, our firefighting gear has a 10-year life, and we budgeted on five complete sets for next year. And to be honest, I don't have the information in front of me. We haven't bought much gear in the past 3 years because it really got cut. The last huge purchase of gear that we've done was through firefighter assistant grant, national grant. Mm-hmm. A lot of that gear is starting to come up. Five sets of gear really wouldn't be enough right now, so that's even going to be limping through. We could really start purchasing more than that, but I am really, the grants are all done this current cycle. It gets me the chance to work the next, you know, 6 months towards building what I need to build in our software to go for more grants and hopefully come to the board with a grant opportunity sometime in the fall for more gear. The rest of the stuff is small stuff like our gloves, our hoods, all infrastructure. Again, it still has that 10-year lifetime in it. We have employee physicals in this for our new hires, which on the supplement 122B, you know, I have cut down that from the 10 that was requested down to 6. I did take out a lot of the stuff like our brush equipment and stuff, mm-hmm. because we can use our brusher gloves for that. Is it what we want to do? No, but we can. And I was trying to find it to put into salary. Without.
Okay. I see what you're doing. Any questions from the chief for this? Yes, Gordon.
You mentioned five full sets of equipment here, and I see that on the coats and the pants, but the boots, are the boots individual? They sell those like?
No, they're by the pair, but there's a few extra pairs in there because in the past, boots weren't replaced. So even though we're buying new gear, the boots that the firefighters had, if they didn't leak, they were still used. And I've got boots out there that are probably 15 years old anyways. The whole 10-year lifespan by NFPA really has only been a couple of years that they started enforcing it. So some things like the boots did get missed in the past, and we have to start making that up.
And that's the same with the helmets?
The helmets as well, yes.
I noticed that they moved some other long lifespan items to capital expenses here. You know, individually, you know, maybe one item here doesn't seem that much, but when you start to just put like one firefighter's gear on, it's quite a bit of, you know, money. I don't know if those should be considered with capital planning type items. I don't know. Something to think about.
Well, typically clothing wouldn't be, even though it's equipment, safety equipment clothing, that's really not, I mean, I've never seen it used as a capital.
Yeah.
I would see it as a employee support budget line item, but I mean I'm tracking with you. I'm seeing what you're saying because it is expensive. You get a helmet, the bunker coat, the bunker pants, the gloves, the hood, you know, the boots. I mean, you know, when you hire a firefighter, I mean, it's not, you know, you hire him for $50,000 a year plus benefits plus equipment. You're looking at about $140,000 for one guy or one girl, and it's not cheap. That's for sure. Yes.
I'm just trying to figure out which number is actually the one we're discussing, because we have the one that was originally in the book for employee support was 40,000. The sheets that we have now, 22A and 22B. So are we looking at
22A is 22. The 32,500 is what I'm recommending.
What you're recommending?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. What we did was
what I'm reworking to try to get more money. The other part of my budget.
Gotcha. Okay. So it's backup material for the
Right, and we, although they're not to the same scale, if you really are interested to what's changed, you can actually hold them side by side and go down through and compare them.
See what's been zeroed out, yeah.
Exactly, or reduced.
So we should basically replace the pages in the book.
With this.
With this section.
Yeah, I mean, every board member does it different. Some just slash a line through the one that, you know, was the original. Some tear out the original, because I like to kind of keep track of what's changed.
Mm-hmm. Yes, I do. Okay. So any other questions for the chief concerning employee support? No, if you want to, purchases of services, chief?
Okay, purchases of services. This is where a lot of our software has been put in. Ambulance license fees, the services to keep the repairs of our vehicles and so forth here. Also, we have our NFPA requirements. Every year, our members need to be fit tested for their breathing apparatus masks to make sure that they fit, that they haven't changed their sizing, and so forth. Here as well is our ladder testing, which is NFPA, and our hose testing as well, along with our coastal billing. It's the percentages that we owe them. Our AED, which is like the police, our automatic external defibrillators. It's our service contracts. Unlike the police, things like for our AEDs, Office of Emergency Medical Services, OEMS, require we have service contracts on it so that our reps are coming in once a year, a couple times a year, and they actually go through our units to make sure that they're working the way they're supposed to and that everything is updated. And with those service contracts, any software changes that comes down from from anyone that changes what needs to be done in our protocols, that includes changing those as well.
Who do you currently contract with, Zoll or?
We have physio control.
You have physio?
Yes.
And that's physio for all your equipment, such as your IV pumps?
We don't have IV pumps at this
time. Not yet, okay.
At this time.
But when you do get them, are you going for the same company or?
I don't know.
Okay. So all your AEDs are through physio?
All our AEDs and our two cardiac monitors.
Oh, your life packs? Okay.
Through physio.
Okay. Any questions for purchasing and services? Yes, Gordon.
Yeah, I see on here we have brush truck service, tanker service, various equipment services. This last year we had a request concerning monies needed for pump repair.
Right, $20,000.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I'm wondering what this service includes, and is this items that belong, you know, are these, because it was in the past, the servicing was done by the fire department, but this year it's now being said that there's service repair work to be done by the town and it goes into a different account. So what are these items?
I haven't heard that.
Well, the pump was taken out of vehicle maintenance, not out of the fire department budget,
mm-hmm.
Which was a service they had to repair the tanker.
But the town didn't do it.
But it went into the town's budget.
Because that's where the money was.
Repair budget. So I'm wondering, we're seeing still vehicle service here.
Mm-hmm.
Wouldn't that go into our town maintenance? And what is the service covering?
During, when the acting chief was putting this together, when the town mechanic and past year started taking over equipment, the fire apparatus wasn't included in that. It is something that I have already reached out to Alan Mayo about for future years, of looking at what he can do for us compared to what we get on the outside. There is certain items like the ladder truck that had that pump done, that's gonna be done by certified personnel. We can't just have anyone working on that pump. But the oil changes and things like that is something that I've already reached out with Alan and in coming days when I go down there and talk with him even more about the future than we're gonna be talking about. But he doesn't have that in his mechanics to take care of our stuff. So even if I was able to move that over to his mechanic at time to do it, this coming year, I'm gonna have to, you know, supplement and get that stuff for him to be able to do.
Okay, so this is for the vehicle's maintenance?
This is for the oil changes and just the...
The lubes.
The lubes, you know, the basic work that has to be done to keep the truck running, to take care of it.
So if, and, okay, so if any major expense comes up like last year, we're gonna have to deal with it because it'd be unforeseen.
You're probably $10,000 light minimum of what you should be budgeting to maintain.
That's what I was looking, because I'm looking, saying these maintenance seem light. And I was just wondering if we had put more money in the other thing.
We actually have goosed it. We've gone from about $6,000 for vehicle maintenance to roughly $14,000. Truthfully, in the future years, you need to be closer to 30 and up.
Yep, for catastrophic failures.
Oh, yeah.
We're looking at that at a 5-year plan, but unfortunately where we are right now, I mean, to level fund the budget the way it needs to be level funded, as you will see through the book, everything was looked at with a microscope. Any other questions on purchases?
I just wanted to clarify, because I didn't hear. So the ambulance license fees, is that for the new ambulance?
That's for the state license, but OEMS.
Okay, and then the AED service contract, that is not part of the new ambulance. You know how we pay for the ambulance, and then we pay for another fee. What is that fee for? That's not this?
No.
Okay, fine. I just wanted to make sure we weren't duplicating. I have no other questions.
Okay, and you did move the $1,000 to building and grounds for the door repair?
I believe Kyle did, yes.
Okay, thank you. Supplies? Oh, I'm sorry, any other questions for the chief?
I'll wait till the end. I have one on a previous page that I forgot to ask, but I'll wait till the end.
Okay, good enough then. Supplies, chief?
Okay, supplies. This is our office supplies, our postage, cleaning and decontamination supplies for the ambulances. We have our medical supplies in here for the ambulances. We have physio control stuff. This is for the consumables on those, not the service contract. So this would be for the pads that we use and the paper and the monitors that we use and so forth like that, and all of that.
Why don't you need Boundtree medical supplies?
Okay, underneath here, we have Boundtree, underneath the original one, there's Boundtree and there's more. It was broken down by different things from different vendors.
Uh-huh.
What I've done in my relook at it is I just lumped it all in medical supplies because, number one, I don't know if we're staying with the same vendors. There's a consortium out there that past administration chose not to use, that other towns use, and I can get a pretty, hopefully I'm looking at some savings to go with different vendors to do that. So instead of just listing them as more medical and Boundtree, because that's where they came from before, I lumped it in to just say medical supplies, because that's what it is, it's medical supplies. It doesn't matter what vendor I purchase them from.
Okay, so I guess I'm concerned that if we're looking at 124A and you've already reduced medical supplies to 13,850, and then we do, never mind, I'm probably not reading this right. I'm all set. I read it wrong.
If you look at it, more medical and Boundtree
come up to
15,510.
Yep,
you know, my version. Both those other line items are zero, and medical supplies comes up to what the total goes to work for.
Okay,
so
sorry.
And you just threw the tower of medical, you just threw the tower on here for to get it?
What's that?
The tower, the medical airway device,
To be perfectly honest, I have not had a chance to talk to my EMS captain on what that is, and I'm not sure.
That's the camera. So when they intubate, they can actually look in and see it as it goes into the airway. I mean, it's a great device, don't get me wrong. I mean, it's a fantastic piece of equipment. And it's a well-needed, well-purchased piece of equipment, so we don't miss, you know, going through the vocal cords.
Yep.
It's a nice piece of equipment to have. I was just making the point. Yes?
My question kind of goes back to what Diane was saying. On your worksheet, I can see we have boundary as zero and more medical as zero, and just medical supplies as 15,510.
Mm-hmm.
But on the sheet from the town administrator, I don't see medical supplies 15.
Because on the one from the town administrator, more medical and boundary, those two line items
combined
come up to that 15,510.
Okay, so but it was reduced.
It's reduced to 13,850, right?
Right, that's
yeah,
right.
Yeah, I mean, I...
But it still says more medical, which I think is that the name of a company?
It is.
Okay, instead of medical supplies.
That's
so
why I changed it to medical supplies.
Right, okay.
But on the face sheet that we're going with...
So we should be using this one.
Right, so this is the one that's... So I don't know if you want to change... More medical on this sheet to just medical supplies.
Yeah,
I
think that's why I was
boundary.
Confused.
Yeah.
Wait a minute. No, sorry.
Because 124A still has boundary.
Yeah.
And it
and
has more medical.
B doesn't.
And it does not have medical supplies with everything lumped together. And 124B is like your worksheet that you did.
Mm-hmm.
It does add up to the 15,510.
Correct.
It does.
It should just say something different. It's confusing. That's all.
Yeah. Excellent. Any other questions concerning that?
Thanks, Julie.
No, let's move on to expense budget.
Okay, on the expense budget, this is, Diane, this is where the payment for the monitors, you know, you said we have the lease payment for the ambulance.
Yeah.
That
oh,
payment?
The defibrillator.
That is our monitor, the defibrillator payment, that's our monitors, our cardiac monitors.
How many of those you got?
Two.
Yeah.
On the top line, the IV pumps, OEMS is going to be requiring them by the end of this calendar year, December. They vary in price. There's not a lot of meds. Right now, there's only one medication that is mandated by it, that's going to be mandated by it.
Mm-hmm.
But as soon as they mandate them on the truck, they're going to start mandating other medications that need to be used for it. Talking with my medical director, they had originally asked the three of them at $5,200 each. The idea was to have one as a spare in case we had one that broke. That way we can stay compliant with the state
mm-hmm.
by putting one in the truck. They offer some, the ones that they were looking at, again, $5,200 roughly, we can get a rebuilt one with a warranty for pennies on the dollar compared to that. For the amount of time we're going to use it in the beginning until they start mandating more, it's better use of our money to buy the refurbished ones. It would be the same exact brand, and we would get a warranty with it to use. And I talked with him, and he was comfortable with it. He didn't have a problem with it. So we had already, Carter had already cut one of the three.
Right,
give us
two.
Two.
Right.
And I'm looking at getting refurbished ones for, you know, half the cost.
Mm-hmm. All right.
And you're still only going to get two and not have an extra?
Right now we're going to get two. If the funds available and what we can get at a refurbished price, we'll look at that third. We have two ambulances right now. We're maintaining, you know, we have our crews on one. That's the one getting used 80% of the ambulance calls. And if we had to, we will make do. I talked to other area chiefs on how they do it, and if we have to take an ambulance out of service for overnight to stock the other one and then get the part done the next day or whatnot. But with the refurbished ones, I think I can, there's enough wiggle room in there, I might be able to get three with a little bit more crimping and saving in other areas.
I think I would be concerned where you're not, I get that they have a warranty, but they are refurbished and.
Also, the one medication that is mandated to be used, the Rutland fire chief, the paramedic, he's used that medication once in 10 years.
Okay.
The other thing is you'll see when you get the quarterly report based upon current burn rates, I think there's a very real likelihood that he can get that third unit this fiscal year towards the end of the year.
Any other questions with that?
So why do we not have ALS, Medistar and Woods, because we're not using them anymore at all?
On mine?
What?
Because the chief tried to cut the expense.
I have a new way.
I'm sorry.
I have a new way to look at.
You guys are really good.
I have a new way of looking at that. I talked to some area chiefs that do differently. And instead of budgeting that money, because I can't tell you how many times we're going to use a backup ALS service. So there's a way that the billing company can do it. Instead of, when the bill comes in, instead of that all going into our reserve account, when it comes into the town, the money that is owed to our backup ALS service, the Woods, the MedStars, whoever that might be, the Winchingtons, the incoming money can get split. So if, let's just say for a round number, you know, we bill and it's $1,000 run, but we use the backup ambulance service and we use MedStar and it's $300 we owe MedStar, we're gonna take $700 and go to our account and $300 would go to a account set up just to pay our backup ambulance service. It's money in and the exact same amount of money coming out. I brought this up with Carter. Mm-hmm. Winchington currently does it, and the chief had given me some paperwork showing me how it's done, but not enough information to get it done at this late stage. That is something I'd be looking for next fiscal year, talking with the TA, the accountant, and setting up the proper funds and the proper mechanism and bringing that back up to the board again.
So do you have a contract with, does this town have a contract with the fire department, with Woods and MedStar?
We have a mutual aid agreement with the other area towns.
Mutual aid agreement. So if we need mutual aid here for a medical call, and they come in with ALS or whatever service, whatever basic or ALS service that's needed, they pick up one of our residents, they take our residents, Blue Cross Blue Shield number, they go drop off the patient, they don't bill?
No, if...
That doesn't make
if
sense.
They transport the patient, they bill, we don't get anything. If we have two basic EMTs on the call because we're not at the ALS level at that time, and MedStar comes in and they provide the ALS service, they're transporting in our ambulance,
right.
We do the billing, and then we owe them whatever our contract with them is.
I see what you're saying.
For most towns, most of our mutual aid agreements, it's a 50-50 split. They pay their portion of the billing company's percentage, and they split the profits on the call, but they're only paid if we collect.
Well, I mean, because I've seen other services where it's paid separately. Like if you have two services, one service's bill is for the basic service, and the ALS service would bill for the ALS service. It wouldn't be up to the one town to pay for the entire ALS service, even though they're not providing the service. Another company's providing the actual service.
Right now, but they're transporting in our ambulance, and the way it's set up right now is we do the billing for that, and we collect it in and pay them.
And we take the responsibility and the liability of what those medics do on our truck.
They also have insurance, and they're...
You see where I'm going? See where I'm...
Yes, but we don't take that liability. They are... In our ambulance, they're doing it to their level of care.
Understood. Thank you, Chief.
When the chief proposed taking this out of his budget and diverting the revenue, what we said was, well, number one, if you're gonna divert revenue, that means we have to go back into the revenue projections and reduce how much revenue we say we're going
to receive.
To get. So it doesn't solve the it doesn't solve the bottom line number issue. Second piece, as he pointed out, was we said to him, look, this is just 11th hour, needs to be laid out for you all. You need to have time to think about it. We need to have time to write the warrant article. So we left it in his budget as an expense, left the revenue in the revenue budget, and said, once you get past July 1, start working on it to present it as part of next year's package.
I got you. Okay. Thank you, Chief, for explaining that to me. I appreciate it. Kel, you had a question?
Well, I just wanted to reiterate that process. It kind of would work like our deputy collector fees. You know, they collect the fee for us, and they send the payment to us. But let's say $20 of that fee is really deputy collector fees. So it comes into our account, and we send it right back out to them. So it would be the same premise as we're already doing for the deputy collector fees. And we can, like he said, we don't know. I mean, it's like a deputy collector fee. If we had to budget for that, it would be impossible because it would depend on how much they have. So it's a very good idea, and I do hope we can get that implemented for next fiscal year.
I just want to make sure we capture everything. So if their AOS providers are doing what they need to do, monitor IV, O2, et cetera, that we bill appropriately to make sure we gain the revenue funds that we need to obviously get back to Woods or to MedStar. That's all. Yes?
I had a question about the ambulance lease payment. This is for an ambulance we currently have?
Yes.
Not for a new one?
No, for the one we currently have.
How old are the ambulances that we have now?
Approaching 5 and 10.
Right.
Next year would be the replacement of the 10-year one.
Okay, so that's paid for. That one's paid for.
Yes, what you've been doing is, my understanding is, you lease over 5.
Yep.
That's done. You lease the next one for 5.
Yep.
That's done. You've been trying to keep them on 10-year life cycles.
Yeah, okay. One of our ambulances is a 2007, the other is a 2014.
Okay, so it's 10 years
old.
Yeah,
I thought this would be like the third, because that happened when we were on the board, so it's not 5. It can't be 5. Okay, so that's fine. So
we're actually due to replace.
We have 2 more years
this year.
Next year.
Next year.
I'm sorry, we're already into the next year.
You lost a year in your cycle.
Just see me doing my checkbook.
That's good call.
You've still got a lease payment.
So, I'm just trying to look at something here.
Okay. Any other questions?
Yes.
Yes.
Hold
okay, I'm holding. I'm holding for
so
you.
So when we, okay, in prior years when we did the warrant, I just wanted to point something out. We would do a warrant article for the lease payment, and then we would do a warrant article for how much money we were going to appropriate for ambulance receipt reserve.
Yes.
So in all reality, I don't see this in here. We have to appropriate the money out, but I don't see the warrant article for that, and I really wanted to read it first, because if we're doing just the 325 and it includes the lease payment and the defibrillator payments, truly to operate the budget for firefighters and supplies and all that, it's $268,884. I just wanted to make that clear. Paying for the ambulance does not pay for a firefighter, a paramedic, so if you're just doing the flat 325, last year we did it in 2 separate, and the year before it was always the lease payment.
Right.
Unless there's some statutory reason or local practice reason of why you're doing the lease payments, and I don't know of any that way, no, we've melded them together. You have to, the first initial year
it's
of
a debt.
Lease, the initial year of the lease, yes, you have to have that. But you don't have to appropriate individually every year thereafter. And I'd be happy to stand to be corrected.
No, I'm just, okay, so there should be a warrant article specifically for the to appropriate out of the ambulance receipt reserve.
Yes.
Am I missing that in here?
Sorry,
I'm looking.
There is something in there if I remember correctly.
There is.
Not a warrant article.
You don't need a warrant article to just pay the lease payment.
The $325, I believe, is in there someplace.
The $325 from the ambulance, if I might see your book.
You mean my messy book?
The $325 from the ambulance receipts, and it needs a comma after it, I think we discussed that at the last meeting.
Okay, so.
Is part of the, is it Article 20, Jeff?
I think.
I think it is Article 20.
Article 20 is the operating budget, to see if the town will vote to appropriate the sum of, we gotta have a final number, for the operations of general government, to meet said appropriation with a transfer of unissued bond proceeds, yada, yada, a transfer of $325,000 from the ambulance receipts reserved for appropriation. That's where we gotta put the comma, anticipated revenues and the like.
What did we appropriate last year?
$235, maybe?
$232.
$232.
And that included the ambulance lease payment, $232?
Yes.
Yes.
And they're projected to go, what was it, $525?
Yeah, I have all that, I'm just.
Yeah.
Okay.
We said we were gonna take a third of the output.
Absolutely, which makes sense. All right, any other questions concerning the other? Anything?
Just my last question.
Yes.
Is there any area if cuts need to be made that they would be possible in this budget?
My first relook at the budget that was given to me to try to work on next year, when I was talking with Carter, was actually about $20,000 more than we're looking at now, that I thought I needed. To say what I can cut, I think I'm gonna follow Chief Bennett's look and say if there's some amount you need cut, I can figure it out at that point in time, but right now, I don't know of any.
And you know, looking forward, at least next year, you're looking at a difference of about $150,000 more just for the two additional firefighters.
Correct.
On top of what we're dealing with right now.
And with the 16 hours coverage that we're at now.
Right.
And trying to keep, it would, we're gonna make more of our calls, generating more revenue, not even including the increase in rates.
Understood, okay, just wanna make sure everybody understood. I mean, looking forward for next year as well, that's gonna definitely increase on the fire department's budget and overall budget. Any other questions for the chief?
I have one.
Yes.
Back on the employee support page, and I apologize if I was out of the room. There's a line item called extraordinary professional development. I've never seen this in any prior year budgets. It doesn't look like it's something that you requested, so I'm just curious as to what that is, why we would need it, and why it wasn't a request, and it's now in there as being funded.
If it's what I'm thinking it is, that's part of my contract for education. So the budget was done before I was even appointed, or we didn't even have the interviews at that point in time, so that's kind of put that in there.
Okay, so that's a contracted item.
It's part of the chief's continuing education. We've asked him to work on upgrading his academic credentials. He's been working on that. This is similar to the chief's, the police chief's contract as well.
No, that's fine.
I think we're a touch under the police chief's.
That's fine.
I have.
Thank you.
His hope is to work towards an associate of science, in fire science stuff.
Okay.
And some of the fire officer courses.
What was the amount of taxation for the fire department last year?
You'd have to add it up, 357, give or take, Kelly?
I think the ambulance appropriation was 232, and the taxation was 314.
Okay, so this year, you're actually at 565,250, is that correct? With 325 coming from ambulance receipt reserve and only 240,250, so you're a lot less coming from taxation.
Yes.
Except for you've pushed the fringe benefits for the firefighter EMTs. you've got three of those people that are gonna be in your fringe benefit.
Oh, see, that's where it's hard for me to do all at once. Okay.
Remember, you had a full-time chief and a full-time deputy chief, and we're going to a different staffing pattern of a full-time chief and two full-time firefighter EMTs.
And a part-time person.
And the part-time admin, yeah.
That's right. Okay.
It's the fringe benefits that really...
Okay, so I guess in my head, I'm just trying to look and see, like, in total...
It's still less taxation money.
I like that number.
The benefit package is roughly about 17. I know it's hard to pin, depending on what kind of plan they get, but...
It's about 27.5, because we are not on a direct contributory rate for the retirement. It's an assessment, so who knows exactly how that gets spread across every individual. It's not like Social Security or other pension systems where you pay 10.3% of it. So I think that if you think in terms of 27.5, that's not horrible as a starting point.
It's better to be
I think so, yeah. Yeah. Any other questions for the chief? Chief, great job. Thank you so much for all you're doing and all you're going to do.
Before the chief leaves, we were asked, we've lost Diane for a moment. We were going to ask for a consensus, as we did with the seasonal laborers, that we might advertise the administrative assistant position, subject to appropriation.
Right.
But more important, we'd like to post the full-time firefighter EMT position in-house.
Yep.
Given this is the first one.
I think that's a good call.
And the guys and gals have really kind of been stretched thin to keep us afloat for 10 days.
Doug, you have an issue with that?
I don't have an issue with that.
No issues here.
Is that okay on both of those then?
Good on both?
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay.
Good on both?
We'll work on that tomorrow.
All right, thank you so much.
I'll stop by and touch base with
you. Yep, please, thank you.
And both those positions will be in-house?
No, the admin will go out to the world.
Understood.
The firefighter EMT, I really want to give our folks
the first opportunity.
First crack,
absolutely.
Because they've really been given their all to keep this first year of the ALS afloat.
I'll be in touch with you.
Okay.
Good job.
Good, thank you.
We all set now?
Doug was going to tackle IT, and I was going to try to burn through treasure collector, executive officers, and then... we can talk about where we're at because we still have insurance.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So where are we going first?
No, I said where are we going first?
IT.
You want to do IT first, though?
Where's IT?
No.
IT is page number 68.
68? Is he really kidding? Diane, are you serious?
Yes, 60.
Okay.
Okay.
Yeah, okay. I got it.
Contrary to popular belief.
Oh, stop it. Stop it. All right, Doug, what do you got?
Okay, so basically, you know, we've got our internet service here, which I really question why it's so high. I mean, this building, you know, it's got six buildings at 1680. That seems extremely high because this building should be at like a 75 megabit, which is more like 1500. Other buildings ought to be more in the 50 megabit range, which is like 1200. And again, I don't know what the six buildings are, so I need a little clarification on that. But there is opportunity to do some renegotiation or change services and bring that number down.
With Comcast, you mean?
Yeah, because if we're paying six buildings at 1680, we've got way more internet than we need.
Yeah, but my concern is no other cable company out here.
But again, whether I'm paying $150 a month for a 150 megabyte line, when I could be paying $90 a month for a 50 megabit line, why am I doing that?
Good point. Yeah. I got you.
We'll look at that for you.
Yeah,
I got you. Okay.
So that's, you know, and that's a typical thing that you put into IT is your internet service. But again, I think there's some opportunity there. Got just, you know, general IT maintenance, you know, computer's got a virus or something like that. You got to have somebody to fix it. We've got 100 hours in there. Email accounts.
Stop.
Yep.
Sorry. Do we have a contract with Montalbano Computer Services?
Not that I'm aware of, no.
Should we?
Yeah, I believe we should.
Sure.
I just think maybe, you know, if we look over, you know, what kind of services he's providing, maybe it's a flat fee. I'm not saying it's a lot of money. I think they do a great job, but, you know.
I gotta tell you, it's a pretty good rate.
Is that the company we looked at?
$50 an hour is extremely good.
That's lovely, but I think we should still have a contract with them.
Sure, we can ask them for one.
Isn't that, okay.
Right, and again, you know, this is, you know, again, it's in here, it's listed as just town hall, you know, I think, you know, for the same level of service, we should be, you know, all buildings, you know. Now, again, I understand police, fire, they may be different. They have different requirements than, you know, general government. But we should be using the same company to support all of our infrastructure, in my opinion.
Don't they use Montalbano?
Yeah, every department pretty much uses Montalbano. So we should have a contract for the whole town, in my opinion.
Yes.
Well, I mean, if we're reaching that level of, okay, it might be $5,000 for town hall, but how much is it for everybody else, and what threshold are we at?
Mm-hmm.
I think that brings us to, you know, 21st century.
Yeah. So you got email. Again, we're using just a very low-end internet email, which is not great, but it's, you know, it's fine for now, and considering our budget constraints, you know, I would not recommend, you know, making a switch at this point in time. We have the annual fee for the website. So in this budget is paying for the Selectmen's copier lease and the finance office copier lease. Again, I'm questioning, why would we pay for finance copier lease out of this budget if we're not paying for the town clerk's copier lease, the assessor's copier's lease, the COA's copier lease? I mean, if we're going to pay other departments out of this budget, then we ought to be paying them all out of this budget.
I think it was trying to bring them all together was more difficult, like, part of when you're trying to, like, merge buildings.
I mean, it does sometimes take time. We missed the $1,000 of the overhead garage doors. We at least had it in an account. We completely missed the HVAC at the Council on Aging.
Yeah, correct.
So I think that over time we can certainly make these
adjustments. Correct. So now we're down into the phone system, which currently the phone system is only in the town hall and at the COA. When Jeff Ritter and I looked at this originally, the savings was about almost $2,500 or something a year, if in fact we rolled it out to all departments. There has not been any concerted effort to bring any of the other departments online, which I do believe we need to look at doing Highway Department or DPW now, and the library. Bringing those two in would increase the cost a little bit here, but we would see reductions in cost in other places. So,
and we'll be all on the same network type deal, right?
Correct. Okay. Right. You know, cell phones and landlines, I think we need to take a look at that. We shouldn't have as many as we do.
What's that, Doug? The cell phones or the landlines?
Landlines.
Yeah. So we have too many landlines?
I think so.
Okay.
I mean, considering we're using a VoIP system, you know, you don't really need as many landlines. You need a landline.
What's a VoIP system? I don't know what that is.
The voice over IP. It's this kind of phone.
Oh, here. Okay. Hold on. Can you hold on?
Yep.
Yes.
I just want to point out, like in my building, because of the fire alarm, we have to have two landlines that are not on the VoIP system.
Mm-hmm. Oh, you're outside the right. Network? Oh, I see. And do you have to pay for those separate?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
I mean, they're part of the Comcast bill.
Right.
They do have them over Comcast. They wanted us to do Verizon, and I said.
So, you know, that's the other option, too, because you're right. The landlines, you do need them for
the
alarm systems and things like that.
Need hard ones.
But again, you know, whether Verizon is the right answer or doing a bundle with Comcast, since we have internet from Comcast in every single building, I think that's probably a lower cost option.
It has worked fine.
Okay.
Long distance, to me, I'm extremely surprised that we have that in there. Because again, you know, they're on Verizon lines. So we have landlines that we're actually paying long distance per minute. I mean, long distance is included on virtually every phone line these days. So if we still have phone lines that are, we're paying long distance on, that's a problem in my opinion. So again, but that's what's in here because that's what we're spending now. So there's not a, I'll talk about the significant differences. I'll talk about the significant differences from the prior year's budget in a minute. The hull copier is no longer on lease. It's a pretty old machine, so that's why we have a service agreement on it. The domain name is something that it would be a new expense this year versus prior years. This is what would enable us to get to, you know, having like a TempletonMA.gov domain versus Templeton1.org.
Right.
It just, you know, again, adds in, you know, that level of professionalism,
yep.
Kind of builds that, yes, we are a municipal government versus a nonprofit organization, which .orgs are what's typically represented. Again, that's $450 a year for that. So if, in fact, we do need to make some sort of cut, that would certainly be something that I believe we could cut there. The Nordic backup backs up the server, but the server's not really being used for anything at this point. But I'm going to talk about the proposal of what we need to do this year, which will then utilize that server. So I would not recommend taking that out. We did talk with Xerox on doing a town-wide service agreement on all the printers. And that service agreement will include toner. So they're replacing, I believe, two machines that are pretty old machines. And they're also eliminating some inkjet printers that we still have, because inkjet printers are extremely expensive to operate.
Is that a contract?
Yes, so it is a contract.
Has that been signed? Is that
$525 a month?
Okay.
Yes, I believe you did sign that already.
No.
Oh, no, that's right.
It's in the budget. I wanted to make sure they were going to fund it. And once you folks give me the high sign, I'll put it on agenda for formal vote.
That'd be great.
Right.
Can you do that?
Yeah, so again, it would be for the next fiscal year.
I got you. We need that contract, though.
Yeah, it is a good idea. I mean, while it includes all of the maintenance, you know, today, you know, we have a printer that breaks.
I have one.
You know, we just go out and, you know, buy another one.
Mine's broken.
And again, the more different kinds of printers you have, the more different kinds of toner you buy, the more your cost is up and down, because this toner's this price, that toner's that price.
Okay.
So where this will kind of stabilize.
And you have staff spending time on things that really they're not necessarily their number one skill or priority, whereas opposed to these folks, they just tend to.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
So then you got the Tonhell copier paper.
Central office.
We got the One Office 360 subscription. Then here is the item, the network analysis and server configuration. You know, we talked about this earlier in a budget workshop a while ago, how we have the vulnerability where everybody's data is stored on their local C drive, nothing's a part of the domain, we have limited ability to control any of that data. This server project, which is going to cost $5,800, what that's going to do is bring in Rudder, who we had do the analysis off of that grant, would bring them in. They would actually configure the server so that it's now a domain controller, has Active Directory, and then they would join every PC in this building to that domain.
How about outside?
In this 5,800, that does not include any other building than this building.
Okay.
So all of those buildings.
So in the future, we could look at that.
Right. So we would have to look at that in the future,
okay.
Because in order to predicate that is we now have to establish a private network across the fiber.
I got you.
To join buildings together in order to use the single domain controller.
Mm-hmm.
But, I mean, this is a really huge step. We really need to do this.
Okay.
Because, you know, everything that the grant paid for and that Rudder provided in their analysis, none of that is achievable without doing this.
I got you.
So.
Makes sense.
So the, we're at a stage, even though it's a tight budget season, we're at a stage where we have to do this. It needs to be done. Then we also kind of looked at how many PCs we have in town. And based on that, we need to have like a 8 machines per year that get recycled. You know, a PC, a typical PC life is 3 to 5 years, you know, depending upon what the position is, how heavily it's used, what types of things it's used for. Technology is changing rapidly. We have a lot of machines, well, I wouldn't say a lot. We have a good number of machines that are over 6, 7, 8 years old,
right,
that are just destined to crash. And again, when they crash, can we recover the data? Don't know.
What operating systems have those on, the old ones?
I'm not aware. We did get, when XP went out of service, I did make a concerted effort to get everybody up to either Windows 7 or Windows 10. So I do not believe that we have any XP machines, but we do have a good number of Windows 7 machines, which Windows 7 is going to go out of support, I believe, February or March of next year, 2018.
So they have to.
So it will be obsolete. Okay. In just like XP is obsolete now, Windows 7 will be.
Okay.
Unfortunately, we can't do the Windows 10 upgrades anymore because July 2017 is when Microsoft said, no, if you want Windows 10, now you got to pay for it. So there was about a year and a half where any Windows 7 machine could have been upgraded to Windows 10 for free.
Right.
But we didn't take advantage of that either.
Oh, great. All right.
Most of the town hall buildings are all Windows 10, and all of the machines at the COA are Windows 10.
So how many PCs do we have altogether? Like, is there...
There's an equipment lift somewhere.
It says 42 pieces on your note here.
Yeah, 42. Yeah.
And this does not include the police department.
No, they get their own Toughbook systems.
Right. So I guess there must be a list, and then you can tell how old each one is and how they should
There's no
be.
List of that level of detail, no.
There should be a list of what serial number and who has it.
I mean, that's
But I guess my thing is that the same thing, if you want to replace all these light bulbs all at the same time, they're all pretty much going to burn out at the same time. So 8 just seems, okay, out of 42, 8 doesn't seem like a lot, but I don't know, imagine if you had 8 computers crash all at the same time. Mm-hmm. I mean, I'd just rather see more of a schedule, like smaller scales schedule.
Yeah, at this point in time, I would not necessarily roll out a schedule that we're going to replace this machine and this machine and this machine, mm-hmm, just because. I would use these as, okay, we've had a machine crash. Are we going to spend money to fix it, or are we going to replace it?
Depending on the age.
Right.
I got you.
So
that makes sense.
Because, again, a machine could be old, but if it doesn't get very much use, it's not likely to crash. So.
Right, but the technology is such that when you use the internet, it can't keep up with,
true,
you know, Chrome updates or Safari,
true,
updates or, you know.
Well, we just heard from the assessor how often hers crashed.
She said that was a specific program. That was for the cart just maps or, yeah. Okay.
Yeah, but she's had a number of troubles, yeah.
Okay, any other questions?
So just to point out, so everybody knows, so the significant changes from last year are PC replacements. We've never really budgeted PC replacements in the past. The server configuration project at the 5800, and the domain name purchase are really the three things that are
right
above and beyond what's been in the budget prior.
But it
prior
needs to be here. We need to move forward with the 21st century.
Yeah.
You're right, Doug. Gordon, you have a question?
Yeah, the cell phones, I see it looks like we have, what, 4 four cell phones. Is that fee for town cell phones, or is that a reimbursement?
It's town cell phones.
You only currently have one employee on a stipend plan. That is the new fire chief, who I gave a monthly stipend to instead of issuing him a town cell phone. We are doing an analysis of the cell phones to determine if there are one or more where it would be practical to do the same kind of thing. Give them a stipend instead of issuing them a town cell phone.
Because looking at, if we have four cell phones there, and I look back at the police cell phones, they said they had 11 cell phones. You might want to pass on your information to them, because it seems like these four are a much, much better rate if you do the math out for those 11.
They have substantially lower usage.
Yeah. Maybe it's based on usage. I mean, a lot of plans now, you aren't paying by the minute anymore. You just, per phone.
Well, I know Veteran Services has a cell phone, and it's used a lot.
You know, I know my company just pays a stipend for using a phone. A lot of companies are finding that's less expensive.
Right.
And I do think it would be cost effective, and that's why we're doing the analysis. So.
Right.
On page 119, you'll see a copy of a most recent bill for your police department usage, and that doesn't include air cards, I don't believe, for the MDTs. But that is why we are doing that analysis, because there are some where it may make sense. There are others where it may not.
We just got a I got a new Verizon phone, and their charges came way down because they have so much competition now.
I think that I wouldn't want to pay stipends for the police department to use their own cell phones, because a lot of it is just, I would never. As far as, building inspector, veteran services, emergency management, that just seems more reasonable. But for the police department, any business that they're doing on their cell phone really belongs to, it all belongs to the town, but I think that I see them all carry two cell phones, their own and the town, because they're personal, and that's, no one's going to give out their personal phone number.
That's same with me.
No police officer, no way.
I don't want to give out my personal cell phone number either. I mean, I have a work cell phone number, which is on my business cards.
It would be nice if we could, I'm sure they will.
Because I don't want my personal cell phone out there.
Well, you can also port numbers now, so you could have another line ringing in onto that and.
Well, we'll do the analysis, because I can tell you that a number of towns have converted.
The whiz kid.
In many instances, the employees actually like it, and it has the potential to have some say.
Yeah, I would.
Any questions, any more questions on purchase and services? Thanks, Doug, that was great.
Oh, he still has others.
One more comment that I would make is that from a technology point of view, the police department and the fire department are significantly, their technology requirements are significantly different than the rest of the town. So to me, it would make sense that, yes, we have this consolidated IT budget for the whole of the town, but I believe that police and fire should budget their IT requirements individually.
Separately?
In their budgets.
Okay.
Because our requirement, it takes different expertise and different requirements to support their needs than it does to support the needs of the town in general. So
keeping them separate will be more beneficial, you think, than having one IT town IT budget?
I don't know if it's beneficial. I mean, it's,
it's kind of like building and grounds. I mean, is it beneficial to have one budget that talks about the entire IT for the entire community,
mm-hmm.
or is it?
But again, I think you're going to skew. I agree. So I guess so. Since we're budgeting them, with taxation also, I suppose it does. Then we would need to, I think, line item them out.
Oh, yeah, fire, police, whatever it is. I mean, absolutely. But I just think, should we have one? Again, something to think about for maybe
next
year.
It's not uncommon when you start to put like items together as opposed to every single department that it takes two or three iterations to really get it down. Like I said, the the overhead doors in the fire department, the HVAC.
Right.
It sometimes takes a couple cycles to get those through.
You want to do other miscellaneous?
Yeah, and then there's, you know, we've just thrown $1,000 for miscellaneous wiring and supplies.
Okay.
Again, you know, you gotta buy, you know, cables to go from the walls, or you get a different kind of printer or something like that.
Awesome. Any questions with that?
Exact number.
Okay, can we move on to
Page 63, if we could, Mr. Chairman?
Absolutely, can we?
I'll try to go through this quickly.
Thank you so much, sir.
Please remember, we currently have 2.5 employees in here, two full-timers and one half-timer. That we're going to 2.0 employees, one full-time and two part-time. This is partly in keeping with the pending retirement of the deputy treasurer collector. Also, we have put in the proper amount for the treasurer collector's certification. The deputy is really only supposed to be 500, and that is only if the House Bill 1411 passes.
Right.
So just keep in mind, this is interwoven with the proposal for the town accountant's office, because we've moved work over there for that person. If you do away with that person, we've got to change the staffing structure here.
Before we move on, I've got a couple of questions on this page.
Sure.
The rate for the treasurer and collector has been increased, so there's a pay increase for this position, which I don't think is warranted. And I really question the these certification things. I mean, the accountant has to be certified, the assessor has to have certifications, the town clerk has to have certifications, and there was nothing in the personnel, the pay, for those. So why are we offering the treasurer and the assistant treasurer basically a bonus for becoming certified, for being certified, when we're not doing that with any of the other certified personnel?
The town clerk does have a compensation item for her certification.
It's like
it is $1,000. The statute does not currently provide, I don't believe, for one for the assistant town clerk.
But was it on the payroll page?
I'll have to go back and look on that, Doug, because it certainly should be.
Not for the town clerk, it's on her personnel. It's on the, yeah, it is.
Yeah, it's on the payroll. It's on the personnel page.
Yes, the CMMC certification, $1,000.
Yep.
It's the fourth line down, Doug. Page 101.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I'll double check the assessor as well.
The assessor's is on there, too.
The deputy treasurer collector, you actually paid $1,000 this year. That statute doesn't actually provide for that payment. So I've reduced it to the 500 and noted that this is subject to the statute passing. And I'll talk with you some more about the compensation on the treasurer collector themselves.
There is no certification for the assessor.
I'll have to check and see if she is fully certified then. Okay. Because I believe the statute was accepted.
The assessor is not certified. She's going through training to get certified.
Right. And it's a certain amount of years. Even if she gets her certification, there's a certain amount of years for the assessor. And I don't think this fiscal year she would be eligible. The next year, I believe, is her year.
Understood.
Yeah.
Thanks.
So I'll double check.
All right. Any other questions with the personnel for the treasurer collector? Whoa. Hello. Yes, Bev.
She got a raise this year? How much for the next fiscal year?
No, there's no raise proposed other than
that she had
if you take this year's salary and divide it by 40 hours, and you take next year's salary and you divide it by 38, and I explained my reasoning for doing that with the treasurer collector, the assessor, and some other staff. So there is a hourly rate adjustment, but the salary remains the same.
the same, it's the same, and at the end of the year, it's the same amount of money they're making as last year.
But you're not working 40 hours.
Less hours.
But then when we go and say, well, we don't wanna work 38 any hours, we wanna make 40, now they gotta raise.
If you go to replace this person, I mean, it had to do also with market equity, because you will not replace this person at this salary.
No, yeah, at least 70.
These are sal-
Which I can't do.
These are salary positions, not hourly positions.
Yes, the hourly is for purposes of illustration only.
So I'm still of, the belief, and I think I've brought this up at every meeting, and I'm just gonna say it, that I think your finance team is the assessor's office, the accountant's office, and the treasurer collector's office, and I still think that it can be full-time, part-time, full-time, part-time, full-time, part-time, end of story. No floating hours, no. One full-timer, which would be your treasurer collector, and an admin. Now that we're through all these years of, you know, 4 years of audits, and yes, I know there's background work to still be done, I'm not seeing the need to staff with two full-time people, whether it's part-time. And yes, I see the need, you know, for vacations and stuff, but I still don't see it.
Well,
I've never seen it.
Well, I think the budget's for one full-time person and two part-time people for the next
and
year.
I think you could have a do away with one part-timer.
That part-timer's gonna fluctuate between
It's
different.
Different people.
So she has a 19 and a half hour.
And then,
that position, I'm sorry, I still think it's just six people.
Understood, yes.
What is the town gaining by reducing these hours to 38 from 40 when these are salaried positions? We're losing services for the same fee that we were paying them. So really we are doing a pay raise is what we're doing, but we're not wanting to show a pay raise, so we're just saying we're cutting hours, so we're cutting services to give employees pay raises?
2 hours.
But we're
reducing. We put all the offices on the same office schedule.
But we're reducing services to town to provide pay raises to the employees?
No.
No. I don't think you can look at it that way, because you wanna look at it, that view looks at it office by office. The entirety of town hall was put on the same schedule. The Board of Health agent is now here 38 hours a week, not 35. There was no increase in pay because they have an appropriate market comparable salary. The assessor did go from 48 open office hours to 38. The town clerk went from 35 to 38. The accountant went from 40 to 38. So these things all balance, and overall, with having everyone open and having the other offices open on nights as well, I think that on balance, it is an improvement in service.
Okay, so I see, so everyone will be on the same hours.
Yes.
The salaries remain the same, so those who are putting in fewer hours before will have to put in more for the same money.
In some cases, if the market salary was comparable, yes. I mean, I sat down with the Board of Health agent and I said, you know, I can't in good conscience offer you more pay because you're already making what is appropriate to the marketplace. And the accountant, I didn't suggest cutting her pay because she's basically where she should be in comparison to other towns.
Okay.
So I think that when you look at it as a package, it does hang together fairly well. And I would stick to that position.
Understood.
Yes, ma'am.
I have a comment on that.
Mm-hmm.
I came in with an excise tax bill.
Yes.
And I knew I shouldn't pay a lease company. And when I came in, there was a part-timer that dealt with me and said, don't pay it, call the lease company and tell them, because you shouldn't have to pay the full year when you've only had the car for 2 months. Well, I got a nice letter in the mail that said, you better pay or else. That was one instance of coming in when a main person wasn't here. Second time I came in, I think it was another excise tax bill, I looked at the times of the offices. Those hours are incorrect on the bills. So if people look at that bill and say, come over here, there's no cars in the yard, so.
You can hear that, Mr. Tenzini?
I'm doing that now, yep.
Yeah.
Because you're right, I mean, obviously, the office hours changed effective one.
January.
January, so, I mean, obviously, some of those bills were done.
Was this a recent bill, ma'am?
Yeah, February.
Okay, thank you.
I received it in February.
I will check on that.
So I'd just like to clarify that our part-time people are fully trained. So did Lynn not, I'm sorry, I have to, you came into the, did she not give you the correct information? Because they're not just part-time people who just do clerical work, that's all. I just want to clarify.
I don't think she should have told me to call my lease company and tell them to, you know, get the money and then I'll pay you what I should. And this is what she told me, she said, you shouldn't have to pay it. So I went on and called my lease company and said, I'm not paying this. Well,
During the day, though, it should be a main, the full-timer and a part-timer.
It was closer to 4:30, it was late in the day.
Doesn't matter.
Yeah.
And then they also should have took you over to the assessor's office to get some of that abated if need be, because you only had it for 2 months.
But it was a lease card.
I understood.
Okay.
Thank you, though.
Page 64 is the $500 for membership, training, and travel.
Okay.
Page 65, we have a $1,500 fee we pay annually to First Southwest, which is our financial advisor on our debt. Harper's I have reduced modestly. I think that's been over budgeted, and they had budgeted initially at 53 per my instructions.
Mm-hmm.
So that's 18,250 for those three items. 67.50 is postage, envelopes, stamps, petty cash, miscellaneous supplies, about $600 on their office supplies. And yes, over the course of the year, I would like to see you look at a postage meter. I think it's a control issue.
Right.
Well, I would prefer not to, you know, do we have to order envelopes? That's 10 boxes with postage?
Yeah, again, with postage, you know, so now you put three pieces of paper in there, so you've got one stamp on it, now you got to put another one.
Yeah, I know.
Or if you had a postage machine, you might have paid.
Yeah.
Five sheets goes for a single first-class stamp. Anything over that, you add extra postage.
I'm just trying to see if we don't have to do that at all anymore. It just saves some throwing
away. I think there's some room around the margins, but there's no real big money there. Yes, you can probably trim a buck or two here, there, and get better control.
Because you're still going to pay for the machine each month, right?
Yes, you're going to end up
like a $200-$300 loan.
Probably $200 a month, give or take, believe it or not. Page 67. I've been trying to push tax taking and improve our collection rates. I'd like to see them in the 98% range.
Where are we now?
You're in the. I'd have to look. I don't want to speak out of turn.
Understood.
You're below where you should be.
Okay.
Let me just say that. Last fall you were doing the 14 takings as opposed to the 16s. So they got the 14s done. We did the 15s about 2 months ago. A copy of the 15 takings was copied, put in with a letter to everybody on 16. Those are now starting to trickle in a little bit.
Okay.
And so this fall you'll do your 17, and then hopefully you'll just stay on top of it. And this increases the budgeted amount for takings for around 10,000, because it's not just taking them, then you got to move them off the tax title list and get them sold, get them through land court and get them sold. And that is the treasurer collector's budget, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you so much. Any questions for any of the pages?
Yep. So when we go to do a filing fee for, like, sewer betterments or some other kind of thing, a lot of times you can take them to the registry and they'll agree to, like, one fee to do a whole lump sum, but these can't be done that way because we do it throughout the year.
You can't do them that way. You have to mark each
one.
And there's also a real problem. I know that some towns like to do them all as the big bulk, but if the title abstractor doesn't catch that,
or the registry doesn't get that quite right, that can actually lead to some real issues down the line when you go to bring those parcels out of tax title or somebody's doing a transfer. And I think we had one of those when I first got here that had bounced around for close to 2 years. I'll go to page 33 unless there are other questions on the treasure collectors.
Nope. I'm good, that's very good.
What page? Sorry.
33. I have put in the salary that you instructed me to use for the town administrator.
Yep.
I will say that on page 2, I thought we put a wage comparison in here, and if not, I will look for that.
I can tell you what they are if you
pretty
want.
Sure. On page 39,
yeah, right
we
here.
Put in the wage comparison,
yeah.
For folks to look at. The assistant to the town administrator, that's the current rate. Some additional time for night meetings and during this time of year in particular. The HR assistant, I think we really need to talk about how to get that done best, but for now, you know, I'm carrying that position there. I think that if we can get the treasure collector, the accounting office reorganized a bit, that position would take a different format. Because you're really not going to get an HR person for $13.50. You're not even going to get a well acquainted person with HR for that rate. On page 34, the dues for the Municipal Managers Association, the Massachusetts Municipal Managers Association workshops, the new TA's conference. You will have to get someone through the MCPPO training. That's the Certified Procurement Officer training. The annual conference for the TA, whether it's the TA or the assistant or someone else, someone should be a member of the Massachusetts Municipal Personnel Association. That's the HR directors across the state. The annual MMA conference, that's the January conference. We had several board members in attendance this year, the town administrator. It is most likely that you would have to give an annual car allowance to any town administrator that you engage. Some mileage for the HR, the Board of Selectmen, when you go to meetings, things like that. The cell phone stipend. And again, you can, you know, say, well, we'll give you a cell phone instead, but it's generally practice in my experience that the TAs just want to get a stipend. Reimbursables, licenses and certification renewals, that's notary public. And then I have suggested a small amount of money for employee volunteer recognition and promotions, whether it's a plaque, whether it's a, you know, the selectmen cook the hamburgers and hot dogs in the summer for all the employees. Something, I think you need to better express your appreciation for the volunteer base and the employees. So I've put some money there for that. Are there any questions on that, Mr. Chairman?
I have none. Does any board members have any questions?
Yeah, I have some questions on
sure.
this.
Sure.
So the MMA conference, you've got it listed here twice, once for the TA and then once for four people. I don't really think we need to send five people to the MMA conference. You also have MMPA workshops. You have it listed there twice. I don't think we need to send 10. So on line 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, you have the MMA conference.
Yeah, I see what you're saying.
He's encompassing all the
sports
stuff,
I believe. You have it again.
The MMPA workshops, I see they're doubled up there, yep.
Yeah, so.
As to the MMA conference, that's one for the, no, it's not for the TA, that should be struck there. But for the assistant town administrator, possibly, and I don't know, I mean, annually that depends on how many select board members
sign up.
This year, I think we had three.
Three.
I think in some years you have had four, but certainly that could be adjusted. I mean, that's
You and I went.
Your judgment call.
And Julie, yeah, Julie Richards.
Everybody needs to go. Three people going is plenty.
Yeah, and that's the board's call.
Would respectfully disagree with you, Doug, because number one, get information there, training that is very valuable. You get to network with other selectmen and other people in other towns doing similar jobs. You know, personally, I got to meet the people at Vedar and the Collins Institute that gave me a lot of background on what was going on here.
But at three grand a year, I mean, I think there's, when we have a tight budget, I think there's probably more effective uses of $3,000.
Yeah. You know, there's price to pay for ignorance, that's all
right.
I can say.
Yeah. Anything else, Doug?
Nope.
On the purchase of services, page 35, legal services, 60. We had 50 this year. I can tell you we're going to burn through that within the next 2 weeks or so. We've had a lawsuit or two. We have a application to the Zoning Board of Appeals to undo the 40B certification of a major project in town. That's going to cost quite a few bucks. So I think that 60 may actually be on the low side. The town forester, that's the contract that we've previously approved, and certainly we can take that out, but if we do, then we need to take the revenue out because we have projected annually either from the gravel, sales of vehicles, sales of timber that will realize 10K a year, which I think will beat easily. But we can't sell the timber if we don't have the plan and the timber cut. So we just need to remember when we cut the expense, we need to cut the revenue that it yields. Again, your pleasure as long as we balance those out.
On that timber fee,
mm-hmm.
The town forester plan, is that a yearly fee that's paid for that plan?
It's more than a plan. There's what he would do would be to, this year he looked at a couple of parcels to tell us whether he thought they were worth harvesting. He gave us an estimate of what he thought they would yield, and he then would actually prepare the bid package. Next year he would do the same thing again. And then prepare a timber management plan, some of which we'll get back from the state, but that goes into revenues.
So basically we're looking at $5,000 each year for the timber management plan?
And the actual harvesting.
And the harvesting.
And the inspection of the harvesting.
But we may or may not harvest every year.
The odds are that you have sufficient lands to harvest every year.
Okay. No, there's quite a bit of town land.
There's quite a bit of town land that's forested. You're not going to be on the same parcel every year.
Right, you won't be on the same parcel, but each year we'll be paying out $5,000 to hopefully get 10.
Actually, 10 is conservative. The estimate that he gave us for the two parcels that we put out to bid, I think we're closer to, I think we were on the $16,000 side. Another questions on that?
Nope, I'm good.
36 is office supplies, and 37, you have non-union personnel who have not either contracted for their salary already next year, fire chief, public works superintendent, or who have not had their salary set for next year in terms of a recommendation, town clerk, health agent, and the like. You have 425,000 of non-union personnel, and I used a 2% pool of money to be distributed on the basis of merit not a straight across-the-board COLA raise.
And then you're in brackets on that last line, assumed, can you tell me what that is, the 425K base market equity issue?
Sure. What I did was I took all of the non-union personnel, what they earned, would earn this year. Then I took out fire chief, his salary's already set for next year. Yeah. I took out public works, his salary's already set. Town clerk, her salary's already proposed.
So you got down to 425 here?
So I got down to 425. Okay. And then I said if I had a pool of money,
okay,
distributed on the basis of merit,
yeah,
2%, I would need about $10,000. Now, this number will spike next year when all those people whose wages were already set have to be dealt with for the 19.
Specifically the highway department.
Pardon?
Like highway.
Yeah.
Are we no longer using, I know the town had a salary system with a step and all that. What happened with that system? And cause
I'm
no longer
afraid its abandonment predates me. I can't tell you why it was abandoned, but I will say that many communities are attempting to move away from grade and step plans, except for their unionized employees, and are attempting to move to a merit system.
Okay. Thank you.
Any other questions on that?
Not really a question, just a comment. I do think that COLAs should be eliminated. There should be no reason for a COLA at all, and merits is the way to go. However, they should be distributed based on what we get as a review.
Yes.
You know, so we need a formalized review process. We
need a formalized review process
before we give any merits.
I agree with you completely. This would be at the earliest in the fall. 17 to be before it was distributed. You need the evaluation tool. You need to know what the benchmarks are.
Mm-hmm. I agree with you too.
Yeah. I would personally like to see, I don't know, I said after the whole raise fiasco happened and we didn't take them back that I didn't want to do raises this year, except for people where we think that are totally underpaid, because I looked at all the salary increases. Some of them were like 28 cents, and others of them were $2. So I guess I would like to see more of a game plan with that, because we don't have a formalized process to do that. I agree with you, no COLA.
Mm-hmm. Not for any reason.
I'm not sure if that would be a number that I would like to see reduced, but I'll have to like really look at it all.
If I can turn, Mr. Chairman, to
yep.
page 233.
Yep.
I'm not going to belabor it other than to say this is your entire insurance and benefits package. I think we've got supplements up the Kwazu there to kind of show everybody how it was completely calculated. We talked about it at some length at your next meeting with the hour being late. But I do want to bring to your attention, in that package that I gave you, just before the police little portion of that package,
yeah,
is page 251A. Looks like this. And at the Insurance Advisory Committee, in addition to the several options that I included in your budget book, the Insurance Advisory Committee had discussed some additional options. This tells you what those various options would say. And we'll be prepared to work through insurance with you at your next. So in the package that we gave you tonight, we gave you the overview of a number of changes that we're suggesting as a result of suggestions from the seniors, from the library, from my meeting with REC, from my meeting with the Cultural Council. You'll see these two pages that kind of walk through what we're suggesting, additions, deletions, how to pay for the cruiser and the like.
Yep.
You'll see all these revisions ad nauseam, and we can talk with you about them at your pleasure, because what we have left to do is to settle changes that you want to the budget. The insurance, and then to go through warrant and to start to get your reactions to that.
Right?
No.
It's been a hot attack, I think.
Technically, we're not supposed to meet after 10 o'clock unless we have a vote to do something.
You look like you're sleeping, Mr. Chairman.
No, I have to agree that you're right.
I just want to know.
Why am I not usually?
Nope.
So the plan had been that the board would pick this up on Wednesday evening.
Yes.
My understanding is that the advisory committee is not going to be able to join you, and I just need to know the schedule.
Well, I think we should still meet on Wednesday. Finish up our piece so we can get ready to give whatever we need to give to the advisory committee, and then we can meet with them again at another date that's available for them and their board.
Would it just be more efficient if we met on Thursday instead of Wednesday, when we could do it instead of meeting twice?
I can meet on Thursday.
I'm afraid I'm not available. I mean, certainly,
that's cool.
If you want to consider it without me, it's your budget, but I
will. We have to do a formal vote on the 10th of April, is that correct?
Yes.
Or are we, right.
Well, technically, you're supposed to have it all turned over, but I think, you know, with the forbearance of the advisory committee, I think that if you could get them the budget on the 10th.
Because you want some time to look at it too, right, Jeff?
Well, that's this Wednesday, that's where Superintendent Schools is coming in and
yep.
going to discuss their budget, and then...
Well, their budget's already locked.
Well, I know, but they're going to give it to us, so if we have any questions about it or anything, we can ask Dr. Kazman.
Not locked until he walks out of town meeting.
But you know what I mean.
Yeah.
I mean, nobody's going to question the school budget.
But, and then we just, I mean, we need our time to go through this besides here, so we can, as we did in this presentation, you see we have the questions that we have.
Mm-hmm.
We not only had the questions, but we showed, well, a lot of work by Paul Grubb to show how we arrived at those questions.
Right.
Concerning revenue projections and... the overlay set aside, for lack of a better word. And I passed one off to all these selectmen
yep.
to read it. And probably, I don't know, Carter can probably answer the questions when he gets a chance to look at it. But that's, and that's just from our last meeting last Wednesday. And it's just at the very beginning. It's just the revenue stuff. So we have still a lot of things to do and not a lot of time to do it in.
Are you
as far as from our side.
Mm-hmm.
And I have one other concern, I just curiosity.
Yep.
We went through a lot of departments' budgets tonight, and all the department heads were here to answer questions or, you know, any items that were brought up.
Right.
And a lot of people came here to see it from them, except for the treasurer collector. Is there a reason why that person is not available?
They had a commitment for this evening that they weren't able to get out of.
Any other questions, Jeff?
Is that your plan on? I'm sorry, go ahead.
No.
Yes.
Go ahead.
Your next meeting, you want to be doing the same thing as going through more of the departments coming in and going through them? Like
no, I think our next meeting is a workshop.
A workshop, the same focus type idea?
Yep. We're going through some of the things we have to vote on as far as the insurance, as far as.
Well, I hope that the COA and the library and all of them are coming back to.
I'd be happy to
go over this with us, right?
Mm-hmm. I'd be happy to send them a note in the morning.
Okay.
Yep.
And then
sure.
It'd be nice if the rec department could come as well, because
yep.
Bill couldn't come before, and then I don't know. I have to look at that paperwork, but the cultural council.
Yep.
That was like totally. It was just spread out differently.
And their monies are in there. I met with them.
Okay, thank you.
We added about $600 to rec and culture.
Oh, good.
Because they hadn't advertised They include money to advertise their positions.
All right, now we're past 10 o'clock. Can I have a motion to adjourn, please?
I'm over.
Have a second?
Excuse me, when's the next meeting?
The next meeting?
Well, the next time that I can come and listen to what's being said and tell you my thoughts.
Okay.
Wednesday.
It would be Wednesday.
Wednesday, 6:30?
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you.
I know it's 5 after 10, but I will tell you that I have one concern about not being able to meet with the advisory committee, and I do not want a fiasco like what happened at the last two town meetings. It was a mess. We're presenting a budget, they're presenting a budget, we're fighting, we're not gonna have it.
Well, no, they have their book.
Right, but they have to meet, and they're not gonna be able to come to Wednesday, and then how do we get to discuss this collectively? I agree with this, I don't agree with this, before we have to, we're just gonna vote, and then I guess you guys are on your own, like.
No, next Monday. No, I mean, we're gonna send them dates as far as what we're gonna meet with them.
Are they gonna meet next Monday with us?
We have to send the request out to them.
I thought all those were already decided.
They were all done, all the requests went out, yes.
Mr. Chairman, the problem is gonna be that meeting needs to be recorded, your meeting needs to be recorded, and we only have one room available.
Right.
So if they're meeting, you can't meet Wednesday.
Wednesday, this Wednesday.
This coming Wednesday.
They meet in here on Wednesdays.
Right.
All right, so we can.
And there's not a Board of Selectmen meeting posted for Wednesday.
No, we can do that tomorrow.
There should be.
There should be.
It's not.
It's not?
It's not.
Nope, it's not.
Because we never got any notice, because I thought we were gonna talk about it today.
So we're not meeting Wednesday.
Can you send? I have a motion on the floor, and I'm waiting for a second.
May I suggest you recess until 6:30 PM Wednesday night, Mr. Chairman?
And then with the advisory? Because the advisory board's meeting.
There's a conference room at the end of the hall they can use.
Thanks.
We're posted and scheduled for in here.
Yeah, this is our place.
We're meeting.
It is my place, my dear man.
I'll second the motion to adjourn. We don't have a place to record it.
Okay, I have a motion and a second. Do any other discussion concerning the recent adjournment? The initial motion was given by Mr. Columbus.
I second.
And then she second. Any other discussion? I see none. John? Diane?
Yes.
Doug?
Yes.
I vote yes.